don't need cash or exact change when you're ready to ride. Just use your smartphone or tablet to purchase your fare. And when you get on board the bus, you'll be ready to tap and go. DartPass, the convenient way to pay.
Rufo Associates knows that nobody wants to need a lawyer, but if you've been injured, get a strong advocate on your side. Get Rufo Associates. Visit RufoLaw.com. That's RUFOLaw.com.
The connection is strong, and as power flows, Delaware grows. The International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 313, and the National Electrical Contractors Association believe every connection matters. So they bring together the highest level of skill, training, and dedication to every job they do in the first state. Because to IBEW Local 313 and NECA, no connection matters more than the one they share with Delaware. IBEW Local 313 and NECA, we power Delaware.
Chevrolet of Dover, the best deals, best selection, and a free lifetime warranty. Chevrolet of Dover, where you get treated like family. Find new roads at Chevrolet of Dover.
You're listening to the 20th anniversary season of Blue Hens Football on 94.7 WDSD and WDSD HD1. Dover, Wilmington, and iHeart Radio Station. Celebrating 20 seasons as your home for University of Delaware football. Every milestone.
He's won his 300th game as the head coach of the Delaware Blue Hens.
And every victory.
The Delaware Blue Hens are the 2003 Division I AA National Champions.
From past legends.
A step over at the five, and Andrew Pierce rushes in.
To current stars.
They give it to Jarvis. He scored twice. Make it three times as he flips into the end zone.
This is the Blue Hens Radio Network, 94.7 WDSD FM and iHeartRadio.
For the third game in a row, the Fighting Blue Hens will battle inside Delaware Stadium. UD is looking to build momentum off of last week's shutout victory as the Big Red of Cornell come to town. Hello, everyone. I'm Scott Klatskin in the ValleyDaysFuel.com broadcast booth celebrating 20 seasons of Delaware football on 94.7 WDSD. I'm up here alongside color analyst Bill Harmon and on-site producer Nick Alessandrini. On the sideline is Corey Nido, and picking up sound from the field is Mike Diodati. And Bill, a chance to stack a couple of wins before heading to Fargo.
That's really a great term that Coach Rocco uses, yeah. The stacking concept. And I really agree with it in that you want to keep building week in and week out, practice in and practice out, to get yourself in a position where you can play at a top level every week. And I think it's so important that Delaware continues to work very hard, as they did last week against a Lafayette team that was at least on paper overmatched, and then Delaware proved that. Cornell brings in some different things. We haven't seen them play. This is their opening game, as we've talked about in the pregame show. But I think Delaware comes in, and they're generally healthy outside of Colby Reeder. We're getting some people back off the IR as well. Our offense is now really working at a high level with Pat Kehoe, and our defense was outstanding last week. So to be sure that you play well in the future, you've got to take care of business right in the moment.
All right, let's welcome in the third member of our broadcast team on the sideline, Corey Nido.
I appreciate it, Scott. Well, Coach Rocco said earlier this week that after he looked at the tape against Lafayette, they played a style of football that good teams play. It's score, protect the ball, and make plays on defense. They certainly did that in that 37-0 win over Lafayette. Look for this Blue Hens team to continue that trend here today in front of a pretty solid crowd here at Delaware Stadium. It's a gold out as well, as hundreds of fans sporting their gold, and to the pleasure of many fans, the gold pants also return for Delaware here today, Scott.
That's a good point, Corey. Yes, we have the gold pants back. Blue tops, gold numbers, gold pants. It's a gold out. Everyone encouraged to wear their gold in the stands today. But after the first two games, all blue uniforms, back to the blue and gold here at Delaware Stadium. That was a big to-do, the change of uniform this season, and back to the gold pants, at least for today. Delaware won the toss moments ago. They chose to defer to the second half, so Cornell will get the football first. Looks like Delaware will be kicking off, and we know how good Jake Roth can do. Coming out of the tunnel when the team ran in, it was Armin Ware holding up that Delaware flag and running onto the field. He's our hometown Hen, a Middletown resident, went to high school up in Philadelphia at St. Joseph's Prep PA, but from Middletown, Delaware. And of course, our hometown Hen, brought to you by the Delaware State Education Association, DSEA, standing strong for student success. Head to WDSD.com and go to the contest page to nominate an educate support specialist for our All-Star in Education of the Month. Delaware going to go left to right, kicking away. They're going to kick towards the south end zone, which is where the student section will be. Beautiful weather. We were worried earlier in the week about whether that storm would come our way and what the conditions would be like, but it cannot get any better than we have it today. It should be a good one, Bill.
It certainly should. I'm really looking forward to seeing how Delaware builds on last week, especially Pat Kehoe, who has been so impressive to me in the first two games. He understands the offense better and better each week. He's building up a great relationship with his receivers, spreads the ball around, has been active in the pocket, only had that strip sack last week, was the only kind of miscue that happened, and that was from the blind side. But Pat has really been playing at a high level, really one of the best quarterbacks in the FCS at the moment.
One of only five FCS quarterbacks with five or more touchdowns on the year and zero interceptions. He's taking care of the football. Coaching matchup today, David Archer for Cornell in his sixth season, 12-38 overall record. And Danny Rocco, second season with the Hens, 13th overall, a 98-47 all-time record as the head man. He spent time at Liberty and Richmond as the head coach before coming to Delaware. And Cornell's players are back and ready to return. David Jones is one of them, as is Owen Peters, a wide receiver. So we'll see if they even get a chance. Usually they don't when Nick Roth is kicking towards that south end zone.
Boy, he has a strong leg. They typically kick from the kicking team's left hash. He's got a little bit of a breeze. He's 7-for-11 in touchbacks. And two last week were kicked into a very heavy wind. So, and I think he was playing them short. Delaware did a good job of covering them. This kickoff coverage team has been excellent so far this season with just one return over 20 yards.
Jake Roth is ready to kick this one away, has it teed up. Ball's in the air and week three is underway, sending David Jones back, and it's going to be a touchback. So I'll now get you the starters for the Big Red on offense. The quarterback, Dalton Banks, the running back, Harold Coles, their leading rusher from a season ago. The three wide receivers, Eric Gallman, who played well against Delaware in their opener last season, Lars Peterson and Garrett Clower, the other two wide receivers, John Fitzgerald at tight end. And the line from left to right, Stillwell, Riffle, Keating, Diamello, and Manning. Manning and Stillwell switching tackle positions from where they were a year ago. In shotgun will be Banks, starting at his own 25-yard line. The Big Red wearing their away white jerseys, and the give us the Coles. He is eaten alive by Charles Bell as he gets to the line of scrimmage, maybe gained another. Let's get to the defensive starters for Delaware. Slight change, as I mentioned, Colby Reeder not starting. It looks like Armin Ware is in his place. I don't know if it's going to be he or Drew Nichols, but Ashworth, Kitchen, and Burton on the defensive line. The linebackers, Jones, Reeder, Bell, and Ware. Corners, Hill and Adewusi. The safeties, Adderley and Malcolm Brown. It's second down and nine, 30 seconds into this contest. And the ball at the Cornell 26, lobbing towards the sideline. Well defended by Tenny Adewusi. It's incomplete, but a flag is thrown, and it looks like that'll go against Tenny, the senior.
Well, they isolated Tenney into the boundary and threw a quick fade. That was a catch and throw by Banks. They're going to catch Tenney for just hands while the ball was in the air.
Interference. Defense. Number 8. Spot foul. Automatic first down.
We'll be hearing from referee Eric Lewis today on the calls.
Result of penalty is 9 yards. First and 10, Big Red.
Coach Rocco still giving it to side judge Darren Patrick there on the sideline. And headset off, still having a conversation as Dalton Banks gets a shotgun form on first and 10 on their own 35. Pass diving and catching the football. No, it'll be dropped by Eric Gallman, saying it did touch the turf. And high regard for Eric Gallman, the wide receiver in his second year for the Big Red.
Gallman injured his foot after a pretty good game against Delaware last year. Gallman, 5'10", he's from Charlotte, North Carolina. Very quick, runs good patterns. Banks loves to get the ball out of his hand very quickly. A good short to intermediate passer, has some troubles down the field.
Banks on second down and 10. Four wide receivers, balance set, in motion goes Thomas Glover, who just checked in. Glover will get the pass on the right side, running up to the 35, making a move at the 40, tackled by Troy Reeder as he gets across the 40 and down at the 42-yard line. It'll be the first third down for Cornell today. It'll be third and about two, maybe three.
Banks gets the ball out of his hand very quickly to the wide side of the field with a little bit of jet motion. Delaware was slanting their line to the right, and that left them about a half a man short, but a good rally there by the defense to keep him short.
They called that a running play behind the line of scrimmage, so Banks won't get credit for his first completion. The run to Coles. He gets through a bunch of blue. First down yardage to midfield. Now in Delaware territory, down the sideline, pushed out at the 40. It was Nasir Adderley who finally caught up to him. Shifty moves at line of scrimmage and a big run for Harold Coles.
Well, Harold Coles is just what you said, very shifty. He's got great hips, good vision. He has the jump cut, much like Delaware's DeJean Lee. Look for him to be tried to free up with a lot of trapping. They pull and they have an H-back in use almost every play.
19 yards for Coles. Four plays, 36 yards on the opening drive for Dalton Banks. The offense, it's Coles to the outside right, and he sheds one would-be tackler. It was Ray Jones who he got past, but slowed enough for Reeder and Bell to come over and make the stop again.
Well, Ray Jones did his job. He was being blocked and almost held out there on the edge. He set it, and that allowed the linebackers to be running from the inside to make the play. So a nice job there by Delaware's defense containing the outside run. Clearly right now, Cornell wants to run the ball at Delaware and keep them off balance with the short passing.
Second down and eight, ball to Delaware 37-yard line. 12:52, first possession of the first quarter. Banks in trouble, being pressured by Ken Kitchen. Will scramble, hit hard by Kitchen and Ware, sandwiched at the 32.5-yard line. He'll be feeling that one as he pops up.
Well, he's a big man, as we talked about, 6'3", 245, can absorb the hits, but that's not what they want their quarterback to do, to be taking those shots. Typically, a quarterback in college and in pros are going to take that slide maneuver at the end to save themselves.
Here on third down, Dominic Cavado into the game. Didn't see him last week. Missed a lot of camp, and he's on that defensive line for third down and three from the Delaware 32-yard line. Banks back to throw. Screen caught by Coles at the 35, up to the 30, and first down yardage picked up to the 28-yard line. Malcolm Brown was there on the stop. Casey Hinton coming over to help.
They're throwing to the wide side of the field to Trips, utilizing their receivers to block. Ray Jones there, and a nice play by Malcolm Brown running all the way over the top to make the tackle at the boundary.
Three first downs on this opening drive for Cornell, marching up the field. It was a touchback from the kickoff from Jake Roth to start the drive. Seven plays, 47 yards later. It's first and 10, approaching the red zone at the 28. Dalton Banks with two wide receivers to the right side, gives it to Coles. He's quick, and he hits the 25-yard line down at the 24. Charles Bell having a good start, his third tackle.
Charles Bell is very active. He skims down the line of scrimmage, keeps his shoulders square. He can run and then find his fits. A good job there by Bell diagnosing the play. This offense looks a little bit like Cornell took it out of Rhode Island's playbook. A veteran offensive line doing a lot of pulling, trying to get that extra blocker out on the perimeter.
See S.K. Howard check in as the running back. We know we'll see several running backs throughout this game. Second down and six, ball in the Delaware 24 in motion. J.D. Piquel, he gets the football on the outside right, gets first down yardage inside the 15. Troy Reeder tracked him down, but Cornell continues to move this football now in the red zone for the first time.
Well, if Troy Reeder's making that play about 8 yards down the field at that angle, that means our edge has not been set quite as well. That was a speed sweep into the boundary. Delaware's got to make sure they get off these blocks a little bit more physically. Cornell right now has great rhythm to their offense.
S.K. Howard, the running back again. First down and 10, no score. 10:38, first quarter. Dalton Banks moving the football. Nine plays, 61 yards so far on the opening drive. And the give is to Howard, his first attempt. Up the middle, and it's Charles Bell stuffing him at the line of scrimmage, maybe a yard. Fourth tackle for the senior, Charles Bell.
Now that play up the middle typically sets up something on the perimeter. Delaware's done a good job of stuffing the inside runs. It's been these outside speed sweeps and power plays that are bouncing that have given Delaware a little bit of trouble here in this first drive.
You're absolutely right. 49 yards rushing thus far for Cornell. Second down and nine. Two wide receivers to the left side. Two tight ends set. Cornell going to check over with the sideline. David Archer, former offensive lineman for Cornell back in 2004. Second down and nine, just under 10 minutes, first quarter. Over 5 minutes on the opening drive. Dalton Banks gives to the running back, Coles. He's hit by Ray Jones, picks up a couple to the 11-yard line. A gain of two, it'll be third down once again. They're two of two on third downs on this drive, though, Cornell.
Yes, they are. They're very efficient. And also, interestingly enough, Scott, they went for it on fourth down last year 24 times and made it 11. That's something Archer, very bold. Now, obviously, situationally here after this drive, we'll have to see what they come up with. A nice play there by Caleb Ashworth, getting in on the hit early on, getting upfield.
three wide receivers, one closest to Delaware, two on the far side of the field. The running back is Coles on third down and seven from the Delaware 11-yard line. Banks going to throw. Here comes pressure. Pass is low and incomplete. Intended for Eric Goldman, bringing up fourth down.
That's all about pressure. He had the opportunity initially waiting for the crossers to develop, and Cam Kitchen did a good job of getting in Banks' face to force this fourth down field goal.
We're going to see Nicholas Knoll come in. Zach Mays, Nicholas Knoll having a good battle during camp. Mays was the field goal kicker for most of last season, missed the final four games, and Nicholas Knoll, who also punts, will try. And this is going to be a 28-yard field goal try from about the center of the field with 9:05 left in the first quarter. Kick is up, and Cornell, after a 12-play drive, takes a 3-0 lead. That's your Blue Hens Radio timeout score with 9 minutes left in the first. We'll be back in just a moment.
Hungry for a delicious cheesesteak dripping with melted American cheese? How about a turkey sub made from hand-pulled turkey straight from the oven? Or maybe
here's your Buick, sir.
Actually, that's my Buick.
Your Buick doesn't have a roof rack. This is my Buick.
How are we gonna fit in your mom's Buick?
Easy.
I like that new Buick.
Me too.
I was actually talking about that Buick.
I knew that.
Did you?
Buick's fresh new lineup is full of surprises. Score big with a new Buick. Current lessees, get this low mileage lease for around $199 per month. Or 18% below MSRP on most Encore models when you finance through GM Financial.
Rush hour or relax hour, it's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
With BEL and Brandywine Electronics for years and years here on the broadcast team. We thank them. Back in action here as Delaware will return. And Bill, an interesting
this is what we call muddle huddle. You have all 11 of the kickoff coverage team right in the middle of the field, clustered in a huddle, and then they break. And Delaware did a good job of scouting this and were prepared for a potential quick onside kick.
Dejon Lee, Vinny Papali back to return. Dejon Lee. It's all the kick returns for Delaware thus far this season. Four returns, averaging 23.5 yards per return. He'll take this one from the 2 at the 5 to the 10, 15 center of the field, and he's brought down at the 17-yard line. Let's get to the starters for Delaware on offense. Quarterback Pat Kehoe. Kenai Kane is the running back. The wide receivers, Joe Walker, Jamie Jarman, and Vinny Papali, coming off a great week last week against Lafayette. The offensive line, David Kroll, Connor Lutz, Colin Wallace also played better at that center position. Mario Farinella and Noah Bay, and the tight end Charles Scarf, who's got a touchdown pass in both games this season. It's first and 10 from the Delaware 17-yard line, down 3-0, 8:55. First quarter to start the drive for Kehoe in the pistol. Kenai Kane standing behind the junior redshirt quarterback. Low snap, turns, gives it to Kane. Kane running into traffic at around the 19-yard line, gain of 2. Let's get the defensive starters for the Big Red on the defensive line. William Baker, Jordan Landsman, Mason Bambury, and Cyrus Nolan. The linebackers, McCormick, Blass, and Segabruch, who's one of the captains, the only captain on the defensive side of the ball. David Jones, Fazion McClurge are the corners, and the safeties, Johnny Taylor and DJ Woolard. Second down and 8 as Kehoe will go under center. I form Owen Tyler comes into the game. Had a catch a week ago from that tight end position. From the 19-yard line, offset eye, Kehoe checking at the line, talking to his offensive lineman and wide receivers. Turns, gives to Kane, sprinting, and lowered his shoulder into a Cornell defender at the 20-yard line, fell forward to the 22. It'll be third down and about six for Delaware.
Cornell likes to load the box. They're a 3-4 team, much like Delaware, but they'll show a lot of four and sometimes five-man fronts. That time the safety rocked down. It was an additional defender in the box. They did a good job there of stopping Kane. Look for Delaware now with some play action to work down the field if that box continues to be as crowded as it is.
I form again, Kehoe. Two under center after starting in shotgun form. Hens down 3-0, 7:37 first quarter. In motion goes Tyler, offset eye as he moves to the left side. Kehoe going to throw for the first time. Down the field, high for Scarf and incomplete. It was over the head of the tight end and a three and an out for Delaware.
That was terrific coverage by the junior, Jelani Taylor, who had Scarf all the way on that low crossing route that Scarf was running left to right. Good defense there by Cornell. Sometimes that extra preparation where they could totally focus in for an entire month on their opposition came up with a great opening drive. I think taking some clues from Rhode Island, and here doing a nice job crowding the boxes. Lafayette did against the run game early on.
Pritchard back to punt this one away. Jones will be the return man for Cornell, and Pritchard sends him backwards. Beautiful kick as he waves for it. Does Jones at the 26-yard line. And we're seeing some similarities between the first week against Rhode Island, more so on that first set of three and out for Delaware offensively, but you thought Cornell ran some plays and had some success similar to what the Rams did in that opening week game.
Oh, I think they took a page out of their offensive playbook. A lot of quick passes. We had one that was actually a pass but behind, so it became an extended run. They're trying to spread the field. They use multiple formations, a lot of trips, but they have a tight slot as the tight end who then can motion. Their guards have done a nice job of pulling out on the perimeter. A veteran offensive line.
Running back is S.K. Howard, trying to work to the outside. Doesn't get there. I think Charles Bell was there once again, and he's having a great start. Five tackles already for the grad student.
When your linebackers make plays on those interior runs, that means your front four has done a nice job of keeping them clean. That allows them to scrape down the line of scrimmage for Bell and Troy Reeder. So a nice job by the front four on that play.
1 yard gain, second down and nine, ball at the 28-yard line, man in motion, and Banks will throw to him. Catch was made by Chris Walker, first time seeing him in action, and he didn't get much, maybe lost a yard. Back to the 27.
Reeder with that 24-year-old, he can run, and he is so athletic for a big inside linebacker. Nice job there by Ray Jones, setting the edge against a pretty good stalk block by the wide receiver of Cornell.
Happy birthday to Troy. Turned 24, as you mentioned, on a Thursday night. No signs of old age there for the senior captain, Troy Reeder. Third down and 10 for Cornell. They've had some success on third downs, 2 of 3 in this contest. A 3-0 lead with 6 minutes left in the first. Banks has time to throw in a man wide open. It's Walker. He overthrew him at the Delaware 40-yard line.
Well, Scott, I think that was clearly a coverage bust. There's no way on a straight. He was the wide receiver into the boundary, just ran a seam takeoff route. Very fortunate there that Banks, we mentioned, he's much more accurate short, has some trouble with the long throws. Fortunately for Delaware, he had problem on that one.
Missed out on what would have been a 30-yard gain, at least, if that pass was on point. Instead, punt unit on for the first time for Cornell, and back to return Vinny Papali. Ball at the 27-yard line in Cornell territory. Null gets it. No pressure from Delaware. And it's short. Letting it bounce at the 40 is Papali. It'll roll down to the 30, taking a Cornell hop. And a 43-yard punt by Cornell. And we'll take a timeout. Your Blue Hens radio timeout scored. Cornell with an early lead. 3-0, 5:56, first quarter.
Concord Pet Food and Supplies with 29 locations. There's bound to be one near you. Visit Concord Pet Food and Supplies today or shop.
So you guys have recently started dating?
Yes.
A little less than a month.
Coming up on 2 months now, yeah.
Cool. I want to show you guys these three Chevy SUVs. The first one is called the Trax.
Beautiful.
Do you think it would be good for moving in together?
Moving in together?
Okay. Well, this is the Chevy Equinox.
Wow. Nice.
Perfect for when you two have your first kid.
Yeah, give me some time.
Okay. This is the Traverse for when you have your 5 kids, 2 dogs, and 1 cat.
Oh.
5?
Well, no matter what stage of life you're in, Chevy has an SUV for you.
We have it all planned out. Thanks.
Oh, say can you see 2 million bucks?
Lotto America is the new drawing game that's sweeping the nation.
Get six numbers right, including the star ball, and you win. And with jackpots starting at $2 million, you win big. Lotto America from the Delaware Lottery. It's the new way to play and win the American dream.
Blue Hens Radio. Delaware back on the field. The offense didn't do anything. Their first time out on the field. Four total yards and a three and out. Their second chance for some action. Kehoe is the quarterback. Ball's at the 30-yard line in their own territory. And he's under center eye for him. Moves Owen Tyler. Turns, fakes to Kenai Kane. Throws down the field to Walker. Walker could not get to the football. Had his man beat by a step, but overthrown and incomplete.
Nice play fake there by Pat Kehoe. Walker running a streak pattern. Just blew by the corner, DJ Woolard, and was wide open. Just slightly overthrown. That was one of those where you want that throw back, but it wasn't a bad one, and it was a good effort by Walker as well.
Thyrick Pitts into the game for the first time. Saw him in formations with Gene Colvin a week ago. Jarman to the far side left in the slot is Vinny Papale on second down and 10. Kehoe back to throw again. Kehoe looking. Pressure coming. Can't avoid it. Down he goes. A loss of nine.
Well, Cornell brings some stunts. They'll use some twist stunts, and they'll bring their edge rushers as well underneath. And that was a nice play by Cyrus Nolan, a senior from California, who did a nice job of looping on underneath and just beat our pass protection.
Delaware looking at a possible three and out once again. If they can't convert 19 yards they need from their own 21-yard line. Jarman, Papale, and Scarf trips to the left side. Walker looking at man-to-man near the Delaware sideline. Delaware down 3-0. Third down. Kehoe throws low, skips it to Jamie Jarman, and complete. Six plays and two punts for Delaware so far on the deck.
Well, many will look at that as not a good throw, but if he led him into that throw, there was a Cornell defender sitting right there in the extended flat to Delaware's left on the offensive side. That would have been a big hit. So Kehoe, I think, very smartly just threw that ball away.
Pritchard back to punt it away. He is such a weapon for this team in terms of field position. Seven punts on the year coming in, almost 42 yards per punt, three inside the 20.
No return yardage last week for Lafayette either.
Pritchard gets it off. Cornell almost got there. Jones will return it. There's some return yards there, about five or six up to the 31-yard line from the 25. And Cornell's offense back on the field. 48-yard punt by Nick Pritchard with 4:55 left in the first quarter. Big Red will come out on offense for the third time. They've got a 3-0 lead.
Let's see if they continue with their quarterback banks. They told us they might start alternating some quarterbacks. We've already seen some different running backs. Their running back, Chris Walker, was the player involved on the long throw that Banks missed on the last play down the left sideline.
Yeah, we were told to watch out for Mike Katniss and Richie Kenny at some point in this game. But right now, Dalton Banks still the quarterback, and he looked good on that opening drive. Delaware still making changes as Caleb Ashworth rushing onto the field while Dalton Banks snaps the football, throws to the far sideline. It's high for Paquel. He catches it in the backfield. Ray Jones is right there for a tackle for loss.
That's that wide receiver screen and in place. Ray Jones read it perfectly. The ball had to traverse the entire two-thirds of the field to the wide side to the right, and Ray Jones comes off the block and makes a great play to start this defensive series off.
Second down and 13 as we see another new running back into the game. This time going to be Jake Derdarian. On second down, Banks gives Derdarian the pass, caught at the 30, up to the 35, shoved out by Bell. Also, Tenny Adewusi in the area, and that'll be third down for Cornell.
Charles Bell diagnoses, reads plays as quickly as any linebacker in the CAA. He's got great speed. This is a player that's coming off a severe back injury last year. He's shown absolutely no discomfort at all. Boy, what a tough-minded individual and a great leader for Delaware's defense.
Trips to the left side. Crowd making some noise on third down and six for Cornell. They lead 3-0 under 4 minutes. First quarter. Give it to Jadarian, the running back, and he is stopped in his tracks as he hit the line of scrimmage. Nice job by Drew Nichols, the true freshman, to stop him.
How about that freshman sticking his nose in there? Did a great job of skimming from that outside linebacker position. A good job inside there. We talked about Cavado coming back, and he was involved on that play as well. Dominic Cavado, the sophomore D tackle, and Cam Kitchen all kind of setting that front that allowed Nichols to make the play.
And we knew Nichols would be getting some additional snaps and reps this game because Colby Reeder is out. Also, Armin Ware playing for Colby Reeder this week with the back injury. It'll be fourth down and four from the 37-yard line. Nicholas Knoll, and interesting formation once again.
This is actually should be an illegal formation. They had too many men in the backfield.
Knoll gets away without a whistle. Pally Soom, room to return. Running to the right, changing direction, getting to the 35. At the 40, flag is thrown. He gets to the outside, 45-50. In Cornell territory at the 48. We'll see if it sticks. There's a flag on the play. Flag is back at around the 30-yard line.
During the return, blocking the back, number three. 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's Casey Hinton, and we'll take a timeout when we return. Delaware football with 2:56 remaining in the first, a 3-0 lead for Cornell.
Hey, it's Scott Klatskin, voice of the Blue Hens, and when my family needed to purchase a new vehicle, we chose Chevrolet of Dover.
Step up to GMC with nearly $11,200 total value on this specially equipped GMC Sierra SLT when you finance through GM Financial.
For Delaware.
Well, I think Matt Simon's got a little challenge here. Keep protecting Kehoe. He did take the sack earlier, couldn't get the ball out. Our receivers have been pretty well covered, but it's been Cornell's pressure that's really bothered Delaware, and also the extra man down in the box that's made it difficult for Kane to get going. And I think we'll see a little change up here. Looks like DeJean Lee is in the backfield.
Lee coming off 93-yard performance last week against Lafayette. We're seeing him on the field for the first time. First and 10 at the Delaware 22-yard line, down by three. Kehoe out of shotgun, and on the RPO, Kehoe will keep it himself. Some room to run. He slides at the 32-yard line. Believe that should be enough for a first down. If not, it'll be within inches.
Boy, a great change up there to get Pat Kehoe involved in the run game. I've always liked his running ability. A great block there thrown by Chuka, the left guard, in for Connor Lutz.
It's going to be second down in inches. Delaware trying to go quickly with a double tight end set. Scarf and Tyler on the right side of Kehoe. He'll turn, play action, rolling out, finds Tyler, caught, first down to the 35. Stiff arm gets him to the 40, and he's tripped up there. First down of the day for the Delaware Blue Hens as the tackle was made by Mo Bradford.
The bootleg is set up by Owen Tyler coming underneath the formation from his wingback position on the right side, works through the line, wide open in that left flat. Pat Kehoe with nice ball handling skills to sell the run, and then a wide open Tyler who really finishes runs extremely well for a big tight end.
Delaware moving the football. And you're right about Tyler. Came back at a diving grab a week ago. I form with Kehoe under center. DeJean Lee is the running back. Offset eye is Tyler adjusts. Lee, his first carry. He averages 8.6 per carry. Gets 12 right there. A first down for DeJean Lee as he was shoved out by DJ Wooler.
The burst is so essential. He finds the crease, waited for Chuka and David Kroll to have their block set up, and then he explodes through the hole. Great vision, great patience, and then just having the genetics to have that burst. Really exceptional. A nice change up here to get Lee in the game for Kane.
He's 5'7", 185. Talked to him on Wednesday. Says he tells people he's 5'8", but he's more like 5'6", with the sneakers off. Whatever size he has been a big factor for Delaware thus far this season. First and 10 in Cornell territory for the first time at the 47-yard line. Kehoe looking to throw. Pressure coming. Lobs it. Papali. He's under it at the 26-yard line and shoved out of bounds. Vinny Papali having big catches in back-to-back weeks.
Excellent protection up front. That was a blitz that Delaware handled. Papali wins those individual routes. A lot of man-to-man with free safety over the top by Cornell. Eric Campbell, the wide receiver coach, has done a great job with Papali, improving his game throughout this season so far.
Seventh catch of the year, most of any Blue Hen, and the Hens are 6 yards away from the red zone. First down and 10 under a minute, first quarter, Hens down 3-0. Rolling out Kehoe, pumps, throws, caught, Papali again. Out of bounds, inside the 15, and another first down for Vinny Papali.
Papali running a turnout route at about 12 yards. Kehoe gets the edge because the running back, Lee, throws a great cut block out on the perimeter, the edge player to get his hands down. The Delaware backs have done a great job this season picking up blitzes and blocking for their quarterback.
What a phenomenal couple of weeks Vinny Papali has had. This is where he catches the football. It's either in the end zone or in the red zone. He has become a big-time player for this Delaware Blue Hen team.
And that's because he's such a good route runner and also has a great feel when to run with man and sit down against zone. A very smart receiver.
First and 10 from the 14 in the red zone. Pat Kehoe takes the snap, throws, passes, deflected at the line, intended for Walker on the slant, and it'll be second down and 10.
I think that was the senior Mason Banbury, a 6'4", 273-pound player from East Grand Rapids, Michigan, did a nice job of getting his hand up. It's tough for linemen on those three steps because you initially set up, you get the first punch, and if the ball's out before you get that second punch, hard to get the hands down of tall defensive linemen.
It'll be the final play of the first quarter coming up. Delaware, it took this drive to get their offense moving. -5 yards coming into this drive. Now 64 yards on 6 plays for Pat Kehoe on the offense on second down and 10. From the Cornell 14-yard line, two wide receivers to the near side. It's Jarman and Walker. Kehoe dropping back. Blitz coming. Lobbing to the end zone. Walker leaps to grab it. 6 for Joe Walker.
The blitz was picked up perfectly inside, and then again, great ball placement by Pat Kehoe. Throws a slight back shoulder in the end zone. A wonderful job by Walker holding off the defender. Great protection, great placement, and a great catch at the end.
Joe Walker's second touchdown of the season. And what an emphatic way to end the first quarter of action. Zeros on the first quarter clock, and Frank Rago on to try to connect on his 70th extra point in a row, school record 69 set last week. Pritchard will hold, ball is down, and Frank Rago makes it 70 straight, and Delaware makes it 7-3 at the end of the first. That's your Blue Hens Radio timeout score. Back in a moment.
IBEW Local 313 features the most skilled and productive electricians in the area. Visit IBEW313.org to find contractors who will provide.
Here's your Buick, sir.
Actually, that's my Buick.
Your Buick doesn't have a roof rack. This is my Buick.
How are we gonna fit in your mom's Buick?
Easy.
I like that new Buick.
Me too.
I was actually talking about that Buick.
I knew that.
Did you?
Buick's fresh new lineup is full of surprises. Score big with a new Buick. Current lessees get this low mileage lease for around $199 per month. Or 18% below MSRP on most Encore models when you finance through GM Financial.
Rush hour or relax hour, it's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
The second quarter, excellent drive by the Hens. We're waiting for that offense to get going, and there it did.
Well, it starts with the relationship between Kehoe and Vinny Papale, who runs so many nice patterns. He's got great hands, can catch the ball in traffic, a really smart route runner versus different coverages. It ends with just perfect ball placement by Pat Kehoe, who threw some terrific passes last week in terms of his placement. Everybody talks about big arms and the ability to drive the ball. Sometimes the timing and the placement are much more important than how hard or how accurately you throw it in a short distance. That time, lobbed it in. Walker did a great job, Scott, of holding off the defender who was in press coverage.
Delaware 78 yards on the drive. Took just under 3 minutes, 2:56 time of possession. And how about Pat Kehoe? 6 touchdown passes, no interceptions on the year. Jake Roth, for the first time, will kick with his back to the south end zone. Kick it towards that north end zone, where more of his kicks have been returnable on this season. Jones is back, as is Owen Peters for Cornell. This one going to be taken from the 3-yard line, near side of the field, to the 10-15. Flag is thrown as Jones is trying to outrun Ray Jones to the outside, and up to the 25-yard line went David Jones, a return man for Cornell, but there is a flag throw. Going to move Cornell back, most likely. A lot of laundry on the field, actually. And the team will get together. Referee Eric Lewis chatting with Darren Patrick, coming over to talk William Moran. All the stripes getting together for this.
A lot to adjudicate here.
That's right. We're about to hear it from Eric Lewis. So we think.
During the return, blocking a back, number 3. After the play was over, dead ball, personal foul, number 25. Both penalties will be enforced. First down.
They got the number wrong on our end, unless it's Ryan Fritz, the sophomore wide receiver on special teams. That's 25 for Delaware. Possibly he was playing on the special teams. Frank Rago wears 25 as well. Multiple numbers for Delaware. That was a penalty against the Hens. Unless it was both on Cornell, which I don't believe it was. Both penalties being enforced. Usually you see the team defending the kick. The one called for a late hit or something on the sideline, extracurricular. 25 was the return man. And the official's still trying to figure this out and mark the football and figure out where the ball is going to go. Right now the ball is spotted at the 23-yard line.
Hard to say there. I think Cornell wins because they were forced to go back halfway to the goal line and then brought back out, so they actually picked up about 8 yards on that penalty by Delaware after their initial infraction.
We see the new quarterback, Richie Kenny. We were told it was planned for him to come out and start the second quarter of action as the give is to the running back Coles. He's tackled by Troy Reeder at the 24-yard line, a gain of 1. So this was scheduled for the first possession of quarter number 2 to be Richie Kenny, the sophomore from Georgia.
A zone read there. Coles trying to cut it back. Delaware did a great job at the point of attack. And then off the edge, Troy Reeder had a great fit coming from his inside linebacker position to seal off the edge.
Kenny had a shotgun form. Second down and 9. Ball at his own 24-yard line after a couple penalties on that return. The running back has the football at the 25, digging and diving to the 26-yard line. So a gain of 2. It'll be third down and 7 coming up for Cornell.
Cornell using 2 tight ends, trying to balance out Delaware's defense. They pulled both guards to the right, veteran guards, both Rifle and D'Amelio. But again, Troy Reeder had a great fit coming left to right to left to stop that play.
13:50, second quarter action as we just get started. Hens with a 7-3 lead. Cornell, third down and 7. Kenny flips it. Caught by Coles. He avoids one tackler. Can't get past Troy Reeder at the 29-yard line. It'll be fourth down for Cornell. Great defensive effort that time by the Hens. And you can kind of see how one long drive by the offense can spark everybody.
If you watch Delaware practice on the defensive side, they initiate every practice with a pursuit drill, and Delaware pursues as a team as well as anybody I've seen all season. They run to the football. They get a lot of hats around it. A great job by Coach Kasha and his defensive staff to really ignite that defense. Get to the ball, a lot of hats, no additional yardage.
No, we've seen him several times. Back to punt this one away. No pressure from Delaware. Papali back to return, and he's going to backtrack to the 15-yard line. Room to run as he tries to get past the Cornell tacklers. Can't do much. Gets to the 17. Good pursuit by Malik Leary, who was there first. And a good punt that time by Nicholas Knoll.
Knoll, with a lot of wind behind him, launched that. That had a 4-3 hang. Pretty good for college. And good coverage by Cornell's special team.
56-yard punt by Nicholas Knoll. And Delaware will be back on offense when we return. 7-3, Delaware on top, 12:47, second quarter.
This is Dr. Michael Axe of First Air.
So you guys recently started dating?
Yes.
A little less than a month.
Coming up on 2 months now, yeah.
Cool. I want to show you guys these three Chevy SUVs. The first one is called the Trax.
Beautiful.
Do you think it would be good for moving in together?
Moving in together?
Okay. Well, this is the Chevy Equinox.
Wow. Nice.
Perfect for when you two have your first kid.
Give me some time.
Okay. This is the Traverse for when you have your 5 kids, 2 dogs, and 1 cat.
Oh. 5?
Well, no matter what stage of life you're in, Chevy has an SUV for you.
We have it all planned out. Thanks.
Oh, say can you see 2 million bucks?
Lotto America is the new drawing game that's sweeping the nation. Get 6 numbers right, including the star ball, and you win. And with jackpots starting at $2 million, you win big. Lotto America from the Delaware Lottery. It's the new way to play and win the American dream.
UD obviously finishing it with the touchdown, Scott.
Yeah, that big 13-yard run, your right core, to get things going. Now first and 10 for Delaware at their own 19. Kane back in the backfield. Ball slips out of Pat Kehoe's hands. It's loose. He falls on it. They'll call it an incomplete pass. Luckily for Delaware, one, that that's not called a fumble, and two, that there was not a defensive lineman in the area to pick that one off as it kind of floated above Pat Kehoe's head. And now an player is down in Newark, urgent care injury stoppage, as there's a man down for the Big Red.
The best defensive lineman for Cornell, Jordan Landsman, was in there pressuring Kehoe, but that ball slipped out. Fortunately, his arm was moving forward, and that's what makes it an incomplete pass versus a fumble.
And the man down for Cornell, as I'm trying to take a look, I believe 58, and if that's J. Edward Keating, he is the emotional leader for this team, the captain on offense, the center, senior, 6'4", 305 from Michigan, as you mentioned, Bill. We were talking about him in the pregame. He provides a lot to this Cornell offense. He's on his knees right now. Excuse me, that's 5'0", not 5'8". So the man getting up off the field is William Baker, who's listed as a defensive lineman. And was pretty close to that football when Pat Kehoe floated one up there. Almost the first interception of the game for Pat Kehoe. Instead, William Baker seems to be all right. That's our Newark urgent care injury stoppage. Pat Kehoe under center. And trips to the right side on second down and 10 after the incompletion. Running back is Kenai Kane. Kane has the football, finds a hole, and he's stopped by the linebacker core of Cornell. Looked like Rice Segebruch, the captain on defense, with the stoppage.
Rice Segebruch is very active, played a lot last year. He's an outside and then sometimes plays inside linebacker in that 3-4, a very versatile player, a terrific tackler. He's got great feel for the game. Reminds me a lot like Bell, but not quite as good.
Third down and 6, not many are. Charles Bell, 2-time captain coming in this year, now a 3rd-time captain in his graduate year back. Glad to have him back. 3rd down and 6, bunch trips to the outside right. 12 minutes left, second quarter. Delaware with a 7-3 lead from the Hens 23-yard line. Kehoe stepping up, has a man open, it scarf turns, gets to the 31-yard line, knew exactly where the stick was, stepped out of bounds and moved the chain.
And that's really smart of Kehoe. He does what we call climbing the pocket. He uses that footwork, realized there was edge pressure coming. The offensive line did a great job of sweeping the D-line beyond them. He steps up, buys a little extra time for Scarf to come across on a low crossing pattern. Nice footwork there by the 6'6", 275-pound tight end.
He is having a good year. 7 catches now after that one. And it's 1st and 10 for Delaware from their own 32. Kenai Kane stopping on a dime, changing directions, get hit a couple times as he makes it to the 35-yard line. Gain of 3, and he earned every inch of that run.
What was really fun about that run to watch was how Kane doubly secured the ball as he was trying to twist for that extra yardage, something he had a problem in game one. That time had great ball security. A lot of tacklers around. Cornell taking some chances with some blitzes and loading the box with the extra safety. So look for Delaware to take a couple shots down the field here at some point.
They've got 3 wide receivers to the right, including Charles Scarf. To the left of Pat Kehoe is Joe Walker on 2nd and 7 from the Hens 35-yard line. The captain, Segerbruch, showing blitz from the right side. It's picked up. Kehoe throws behind his man, Jarman. It's dropped at the 38.
Well, Segerbruch was coming off Delaware's left side. Kane in perfect position to pick up the blitz. As Kehoe delivered that ball, there was a lineman in his face, and I think that obscured his vision a little bit, lost the timing, and that's why the ball was thrown behind.
Kehoe, 5 of 11 so far today. Does have the tough touchdown toss to Joe Walker of 14 yards. That's Delaware's only score, 7-3, their lead, 10:46. Second quarter action. It's 3rd down and 7, Delaware. 1 of 3 on 3rd down today. Kehoe out of shotgun to the left stands Kenai Kane. 2 wide receivers to both sides. Kehoe gets a snap. Pressure coming down goes Pat Kehoe. It was Lance Blass, the linebacker, sophomore from Pennsylvania, who came in seemingly unblocked and brought down the quarterback. It'll be 4th for the Hens.
That was a full-out zone blitz there by Cornell. A nice call by their defensive coordinator, who did a good job of scouting Delaware. Clearly on that, he knew there was going to be drop back, brings the pressure from the edge, but there was also some solid pressure up inside by Landsman that forced him outside to complete the play.
Jared Backus, the defensive coordinator, dialing that one up, and 4th and 17 for Delaware. Pritchard back to punt this one away, barely gets it off. Good pressure by Cornell, and it's going to be a fair catch at the 37-yard line by David Jones. And there is a flag back at the 30 of Delaware's territory. Seen a lot of flags on special teams today thus far.
Well, that could be the result of Cornell making some mistakes because it's their first game and haven't had a chance to look at a lot of tape to straighten it out. Troy Reeder involved in something over there. I think he was possibly held up.
I'll tell you what, this officiating crew, not in any hurry to discuss what the flag was. Moseying up the field went to Eric Lewis. Finally, we'll get the call. They are not busy tonight. I know that. They have no plans later this evening. Still just chatting. Turn the mic back on.
During the return, holding, 23, 10-yard penalty, 1st down.
What you could not hear, and what the official usually says, is what team the penalty was on. But it was against Cornell. And the penalty against Jelani Taylor, the junior safety. I want to remind our listeners that we partner with Unique Impressions every offseason. There's a reason we keep going back to Unique Impressions for all of our apparel and embroidery needs. The quality and customer care are unmatched, and they are conveniently located right on East Main Street in Newark. And a big congratulations to Donna Odell Hoke, owner of Unique Impressions, for celebrating 30 years of business. Go see why Donna was named 2013 Entrepreneurial Woman of the Year by the Newcastle County Chamber of Commerce, and why the business won the Superstars in Business Award from the Delaware State Chamber of Commerce. Let them make an impression on you. Unique Impressions, shop uniqueimpressions.com. So Cornell back on the field. We'll see if we get Kenny at quarterback or Dalton Banks, who led the team in quarter number one. Looks like Richie Kenny is going to get another go. Dalton Banks was the only quarterback last year against Delaware, throwing for 247 against the Hens, and now a little bit of a rotation, and we continue to rotate running backs as Delonte Harrell is out for the first time for Cornell. as Kenny goes in shotgun form. We'll keep it. Pressure coming. Buchanan gets a hit on the quarterback, forcing him to throw high and incomplete.
Delaware getting a couple of their young players in. Johnny Buchanan, as you just mentioned, does a good job of pressuring from his inside linebacker position. And Kendrick Whitehead coming in to play that outside linebacker position on the left side. So good substitutions here by Delaware's defensive staff.
You got Whitehead, like you said, Buchanan, Bell, and Armin Ware out there for Delaware right now. A readerless defense for the Hens at the moment. Troy active today. Colby is not. Second down and 10 as the newly inserted running back runs into Cam Kitchen. Not a good place to be if you're a running back at the 27-yard line. So a gain of one. It'll be third down and long for Cornell. 7-3 lead for Delaware, 9:42 second quarter.
It's so important for those inside linebackers to be able to work down the line of scrimmage, and they can only do that when those defensive linemen actually occupy almost two blockers, both Burden and, of course, Cam Kitchen, who made the play, do a great job of keeping their shoulders square. Laverne Bielan has done a great job of working those guys with their techniques.
Reader back in the game. Troy, that is. Harrell's running back. Third down and 8. Pass caught. First down. The tight end has it up to the 41-yard line. That'll move the chain as the catch was made by John Fitzgerald, the starting tight end.
Kenny, the quarterback, had ample time. He was able to step up and to the pocket, but also allowed his tight end to work across the formation. Now, that time, Delaware a little deep in their coverage. You'll see them tighten up. A nice play by Reeder coming to make the tackle.
And a change within a drive, interesting, as Mike Katniss will be the quarterback for this snap. First and 10 at the Cornell 41. Pumping is Katniss. Here comes Armin Ware, tracking him down, and the sack. Armin Ware got the start for the injured Colby Reeder and making the most of his extra reps, the first sack of the season for the senior from St. Joseph's Prep.
Right tackle, Mason Manning had no chance there. He could not push out. Armin Ware had a great speed rush. You see that a lot in the pros where they dip and run the bend, and he just runs the new quarterback down from the backside.
Welcome to college football, Mike Katniss. His first snap, and the senior Armin Ware brings him down. Second down and 21, pass thrown high. Catch is made at the 36. Nigel Hill with the tackle at the 37-yard line. And it was Davey Lozana, the junior from Maryland.
Teams don't throw much at Nigel Hill. He has good coverage. That's only his third tackle in the season. That's because his area hasn't been targeted much, but a very fine open field tackle. Much harder to do than people think. Closing, keeping your balance, and making sure you secure it, because if you miss there, it's going to be a big play against you.
Nine pass breakups as a true freshman will do that to you. Nigel Hill led the team last year in that category. Crowd on their feet for third and 14 for Cornell. Down the sideline, Lozada's a target again. Incomplete, out of bounds. It'll be fourth down for Cornell.
We talk about press man, and in that case, Tenny Adewusi did a great job of keeping his hands on the receiver as he runs a little wheel route. Tenny in perfect position, actually so physical he forced the offensive player out of bounds. So excellent coverage there by Tenny Adewusi.
See Nicholas Null again. After that first drive where Nicholas Null was the one who kicked the 28-yard field goal to get Cornell on the board, Cornell has not moved the football much. 7-3 is Delaware's lead, 7:29, second quarter. And fourth and 14 for Nicholas Null. No pressure. Papali back to return. It's short, a line drive. It hops. Papali will take it from the 18 off of the bounce. And he'll be dropped there. A couple of big red players were in the area. Colby McGowan made the stop. And 50-yard punt by Nicholas Null.
What I like there about Finney Papali was he saved another 5 to 10 yards as the ball was rolling back towards Delaware's goal line. A lot of returners will stay away. At that point, he works his body over, gets in perfect position, and just downs it, so it would not have had additional yardage.
Official mark is the 17-yard line for Delaware's drive. 79 yards of offense for Delaware, 78 for Cordell. Most of those yards coming on the opening drive for the Big Red. Delaware leads by 4 on first and 10 as Kehoe goes under center, drops back, throws downfield, looking for Walker. Walker under it, and the catch is made at the 40-yard line. Down he goes at the 41.
Terrific throw by Pat Kehoe as he steps into that throw. Walker just runs a streak route by DJ Woolard, one of their better defensive backs, and a wonderful catch over his shoulder. Again, really good ball placement on the long throw by Pat Kehoe, allowed because the offensive line held off that rush.
Joe Walker having a day. A big pickup there of 42 yards. He already has a touchdown. Here's Kenai Kane. Turns the corner at the sideline. Rumbling to the 31. And they'll give him 9. It'll be second down and 1.
And Kenai Kane has the ability to get his shoulders horizontal and square down the field. He is a big load to tackle. A nice block on the edge by Owen Tyler, the H-back, who's very clever at finding the right angles to get players like Lee and Kane free out on the outside. So nice job there by Delaware's front.
I'll correct myself. They do give him first down yardage. First and 10 for Delaware as Kehoe goes under center. In the game is McElhaney on the left side. To the right, Papali and Jarman. Kane, a runner behind Owen Tyler in the eye. There was a little bit of movement. Kane gets the carry at the 30. Down he goes at the 27-yard line. Thought Tyler might have got a head start, but no whistle.
That was a pretty solid run considering there were 9 Cornell players within about 4 yards of the line of scrimmage. They're taking some chances here. That's what opens up the passes to Walker and Papali down the field.
Mo Bradford made the tackle. Second down and 7. 5:55, second quarter. Delaware up 7-3. This drive sparked by a 42-yard catch by Joe Walker. Under center is Kehoe from the Cornell 28-yard line. Kane still the runner. Kehoe has some time, throws, and it looked like a miscommunication. Ball drops incomplete to Vinny Papali at the 5-yard line. Papali was not looking for it, and since there was some confusion, lucky that no Cornell player was in the area.
5 substitutes in for Cornell. We heard they were going to play a lot of different people. Some teams use a NASCAR personnel, meaning they're bringing in their faster players on third and long to get pass rush and also the nickel or the dime back in for coverage reasons. That time, Kehoe just misread the defense. They played zone. They've been playing a lot of press man. That time it was zone, and that's what had the miscue from Kehoe.
Hens 1 of 4 on third down. Cornell showing some pressure on 3rd and 7. From the Cornell 28, play action. Kehoe. Tossing, middle of the field. Jarman can't get under it as it was knocked out of his hands by David Jones. The ball was up there seemingly forever. Jarman twisting and turning to find the football, and Jones throwing his left arm out and knocking it away at the last moment.
That was a terrific play by the player from Sugarland, Texas, David Jones. He had coverage on the post. Jarman did a great job of tracking the ball, made that little adjustment right at the end. A really nice play by Jones, sticking his hand in right at the last moment.
45-yard field goal try coming up for Frank Rango. He made a 48-yard try against URI. 2 of 3 this season. Trying to give the Hens a 7-point lead. Pritchard holds, spins, Rango's kick, has the distance, but it's no good. It's wide and to the left for Frank Rango, so the score remains 7-3 with 5:23 remaining in the second quarter.
Scott, I like the fact that Delaware's taking some shots down the field with that defense where they're playing so many people up close to the line of scrimmage in that press man-to-man. That just asked for that, and I think Matt Simon's been right. Kehoe's had some good throws, maybe just a little off on that one. The wind may have affected the ball, but the concept by Delaware, very strategic here at the moment to take those shots down the field.
See, Banks back in the game. Starting quarterback, Banks, 4 of 7, only 7 yards. Cole's the starting running back, and he is hit hard as he tries to get through the hole on the left side. I believe it was Charles Bell who came flying in there. Last up is Casey Hinton, but Bell with his 6th tackle of the game. Malcolm Brown in on the stop as well. Brown's been busy, 8 tackles for him.
Well, you're right about Bell running so hard downhill to make that tackle, but it was really a result of Troy Reeder getting his perfect fit to bounce the ball out to Bell, who finishes off the play.
And in motion for Dalton Banks, throws it to him. We saw this play on the opening drive, but it goes nowhere this time. That man again is Malcolm Brown making the tackle at the 27. No gain, 3rd and 10 coming up.
Delaware has adjusted, and that's what smart teams do, and well-coached teams have the habit of figuring out what a team's trying to do to them, adjust. Malcolm Brown downhill. A nice play there by Casey Hinton, also being in the vicinity, getting some time out there at the right corner.
Hens asking for some noise from this Delaware Stadium crowd on 3rd down and 10. Cornell 3 of 8 on 3rd down thus far. Trips to the left side. Pressure coming. Banks pumps. Now he's running for his life. Spinning. Kitchen grabs him at the 30. Down he goes. A gain of only two, but there was a flat.
Probably a hold. A good pressure inside by Bell and Troy Reeder on a twist stunt to get Bell to flush him out of the pocket.
Waiting on the call from Eric Lewis, who again has some extra chatter after the flag was thrown. Two flags thrown back at the 25-yard line. He's talking with Coach Rocco right now.
Personal foul, chop block on the offense. That penalty is declined, fourth down.
Delaware declining the penalty, and that's the third penalty on Cornell if it would have been accepted. Two penalties for 19 yards, three penalties for 34 yards so far for Delaware. And again, we are going to see Nicholas Knoll on the punt this one away.
Good stand there by Delaware. I like the adjustment that Coach Kosh and his staff did on the wide receiver screens, the plays out on the perimeter, and Charles Bell and Troy Reeder really taking over the game on the inside.
Fifth punt of the day for Nicholas Knoll coming up. And Papali back to return. No pressure again for Knoll. It's high. Papali's under it. Waves for it at the 25-yard line. And Delaware's offense will come back out with 3:40 remaining in this first half of football. We'll take a timeout with 3:40 left in quarter number two.
Lots of things take 15 minutes, like sitting through a halftime show or running a very slow mile.
Step up to GMC with nearly 11,200 total value on this specially equipped GMC Sierra SLT when you finance through GM Financial.
Total offense, Cornell at 80 total yards, and Delaware winning on third down, and you'd like the work of Delaware's defensive line.
Boy, do I ever. Armin Bell had that nice sack off the left edge. Brandon Hall's been getting a lot of reps here this afternoon, along with Caleb Ashworth, of course, Frank Burden, and Cam Kitchen, Saul Morrow. So that front is really developing. As you can play in these games and you get that much depth, it's only going to help you down the road in the fourth quarter.
It was a group that Coach Rocco needed to improve the most, losing two guys to the NFL in Woodson and Bilal Nichols, and playing well today. First and 10 for Delaware from their own 25-yard line. Pressure coming up the middle. Kehoe will keep it on the RPO to the outside. Five-yard pickup, maybe six to the 31. And the tackle made by Mason Banbury for Cornell.
Talking to Coach earlier in the year, he spoke about Pat Kehoe's maturity, not only mentally understanding the offense, but physically, how he really bought into the weight room. Chris Stewart, the strength and conditioning coach, really loves Kehoe's attitude in there. He's very physical, and that allows him to run on those RPOs, as you've described, and take that physical punishment and get right back up.
Kehoe named a captain towards the end of camp, and that's, you win being captain. You win those votes in the locker room and in the weight room, like you said. Trips to the left side. Kehoe on second down and four. Lobs it towards the sideline, and McElhaney can't turn around to get it. Incomplete.
Well, that's one of those things where McElhaney doesn't get a lot of reps, so their timing and relationship's going to be a little bit off. Pat Kehoe threw that ball a little bit more to the sideline. I thought McElhaney did a nice job of stacking the cornerback, but the ball was just overthrown over his shoulder.
So quickly it becomes third down for Delaware. Third and four, 2:55. Two plays, 6 yards so far on this drive. It started at the 25-yard line. Dejon Lee is the runner. Bunch trips to the left of Kehoe. And Joe Walker on the far side to his right. A 7-3 lead for Delaware. Kehoe out of shotgun. Low snap. throws on the cross. It's Walker running for first down yardage. And he's down at the 39. The tackle was made by Jake Watkins, but not before Walker showed that speed and moved the chain.
Walker is such a terrific receiver because of his frame. He shows as he runs those crossing patterns his number three, to Kehoe. He comes at about 80-85% when makes it easier for Kehoe to make that throw, and then does a great job after the catch of getting the ball in the proper hand and exploding up the field.
Three catches, 64 yards and a score for Joe Walker. Heck of a first half for the former QB. Our quarterback now, Pat Kehoe, down the field to Jamie Jarman, overthrows him at the 30-yard line, giving chase once again was Jake Watkins, also David Jones in protection.
It's good to see Pat Kehoe take these shots down the field. I know right at the moment it doesn't feel like they're doing anything, but what that does is it stretches the defense vertically. It makes them start to change some of their coverage concepts. Eventually, this is going to pay off bonus, and then it opens up those crossing patterns as we saw to Joe Walker and then Charles Scarf earlier on in the game.
Four targets now to Jarman, zero catches for the senior from Indian River. Second down and 10 for Delaware at their own 39-yard line, 2:16. Clock stopped after the incompletion in the second quarter. Kehoe throwing again. Walker open again, and another catch at the 30. Down at the 22-yard line is Joe Walker, having the best day of his career as a wide receiver.
Joe Walker winning the one-on-one matchup. They're playing, as I mentioned, a lot of press man with a free safety. When you split Walker or Jarman out to the edge, that safety's got too far to go. They inserted some pressure, was picked up, and Kehoe delivers a perfect pass right over the inside shoulder of Walker, running another streak pattern.
Joe Walker is such a talent, and it is on full display today thus far. Four catches, 103 yards for Walker. The give to Lee on first and 10, 2 yards away from the red zone. Now they're in the red zone at the 20. Tackle made by Colby McGowan, and Delaware is going to call a timeout. It'll be second down and 8 from the 20. 95 seconds left in the first half, and the Hens lead 7-3.
Well, nice timeout there by Coach Rocco. He wants to chat it over here, stop the clock, give plenty of time to get another first down and not have to use his timeouts till right at the end. I really like the game plan of Matt Simon. We've been probing down the field, some under cross patterns once the defense gets stretched out. Delaware with Lee and Sproul and Kane being able to get to the outside now. That, again, opens up those inside running routes and also the crossing pattern. So though it hasn't yielded a lot of points, I think the horizontal and the vertical effect of the strategy this afternoon in the passing game is eventually going to win out.
Delaware in the red zone one other time in this ball game. It ended with a 14-yard touchdown toss to Joe Walker. Walker has gotten Delaware to this position with a big-time catch and a first-down pickup on third down earlier in the drive. This is the seventh play of the drive coming up. Kehoe under center. Lee, the running back. They'll go play action. Kehoe looking middle of the field, and it's incomplete again for Jamie Jarman. This time a flag is thrown late, and I believe it might be pass interference against Cornell. Officiating crew talking things over. The flag was thrown in the direction of Cornell. And we'll hear Eric Lewis once again. A lot more laundry than we had a week ago against Lafayette.
Pass interference. Defense, number 25. 15-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
That's David Jones. That sets up Delaware with first and goal to go from the 5.
That was a deep post pattern there by Jarman. And Kehoe threw it, threw him open, as we call it. He didn't wait till he was open. He threw him open. And the PI is what affected the player, would have been a completion for a touchdown.
Now a timeout taken by David Archer. He is furious on the sideline. And the timeout taken by Cornell is their first. So we've got a stoppage as Delaware will have first and goal to go from the 5 with 90 seconds left in the first half. Excel Business Systems is the official business system partner of Blue Hens Radio and iHeartRadio Delaware, and the company with more tenure in the industry. Since 1984, Excel has valuable relationships and experience with customers, partners, and manufacturers, and Excel has fully knowledgeable sales, service, and IT support delivery teams. We love working with Excel at iHeartMedia, and your business will too. Visit exceldigital.com. Delaware, a lot of options here. 90 seconds left in the first half. And they're looking to expand on their lead before heading into the locker room. First down and five. We've seen Dejon Lee. Do you maybe insert the powerful back Kenai Kane in this situation?
I would think they would pound it out here behind that big offensive line. Cornell's done a pretty good job on Kane inside, but if you can get Kane off the edge, I think they might be successful. Archer, next offensive lineman there, irate about the call. I unfortunately didn't see the replay, but the PI, I think, happened as the ball was in the air. Jarman really running a sharp pattern down there, and I think he would have caught the ball had it not been for the interference.
It was not obvious, and the flag was thrown late.
They're going with the small back, Scott, going with Lee.
See Dejon Lee, an opportunity to perhaps get his first career touchdown run. First and goal to go from the five. Delaware leads 7-3. Now Lee out of the backfield. Empty backfield for Kehoe. Trips to the right side. Kehoe gets the snap, keeps it himself, tucks, runs, scores, Pat Kehoe.
That's a really good play call by Matt Simon. You empty out the backfield, you have your H-back to the side to have additional blocking. Kehoe makes a quick little fake as if he's going to throw it, puts his back foot in the ground, and gets that big body running downhill for the touchdown.
6'4", 240. You talk big body, the work he did in the weight room with Chris Stewart, and he's a hard guy to bring down. There weren't too many would-be tacklers in his area before he got across the goal line. A 13-3 lead for Delaware. You're right, Bill. That play call was well done by Matt Simon, and now Pat Kehoe makes it, Frank Rago makes it 71 in a row. Good on the extra point. And Delaware's lead is 14-3. That's a seven-play, 75-yard drive that took just 2 minutes and 9 seconds off the clock. It ends with a five-yard rush TD by Pat Kehoe. Pat Kehoe now has 6 touchdown tosses and 1 rushing TD and no turnovers.
Boy, is he efficient. I know he's missed a couple of those passes, but that's something you're building for the future. You have concentrated in the first couple games throwing a lot of the intermediate and short passes, now taking some chances down the field. I really like the strategy, stretching the field, as we mentioned, vertically, as well as the expansion of the field, just adds to another dimension to your pass game, Scott.
And how about our former quarterback, Joe Walker, 4 catches, 103, a big third down catch that got the chains moving. The chain moving, and then a big-time catch getting Delaware into Cornell territory.
And, Scott, let's not forget, Joe Walker, this is only his third game, actually 2 games and a half, a wide receiver, and I think every game he picks up a lot. You really want to credit Danny Rocco for making that decision to move Joe Walker. Also, Eric Campbell's done a magnificent job with Joe Walker and teaching him all the intricacies of it. Eric Campbell, a great receiver himself at the University of Michigan.
You say 2.5 games really of knowing how to play wide receiver. He played last year but was just kind of thrown out there and used pure athleticism to be effective. Now we have an offseason and a summer to learn how to play the position, and he looks very skillful out there with 103 yards. Now Roth will kick this one away. Jones waving for it at the 2-yard line. And that's the first time we've seen this new rule. You can call a fair catch at anywhere on the field, and it will be a touchback. And I was waiting for that in one of these games to explain, as there is a flag on the play. No, that's our fourth flag on a special teams play, either a punt or a kickoff. So a lot of action away from the ball on these special teams plays.
After the play was over, personal foul, number one. After this is a goal. First down.
And that's on Cornell. Either Dylan Otulski, a wide receiver, or Fazion McClurge, who is a cornerback that they really like for Cornell. But what do you make of the new rule of the fair catch that we just saw?
Well, I'm a big special teams guy, so I think kickoff returns and kickoff coverage are really exciting. I understand why they're doing it, Scott.
Right.
They're protecting players. Statistically, I believe they've proved that you get a few more injuries on these kickoff situations. So from that standpoint, it's a great rule. Outside of the game changing a little bit and really giving an advantage or taking away the advantage of a good kickoff man.
Banks will throw on first down, trips to the left side, passes caught by Lars Peterson, his second catch of the day. And Cornell going to go quickly, try to see if they can get into some scoring range with 80 seconds left in the second quarter. Two wide receivers of both sides. Four backs back in the game. We see three quarterbacks for Cornell. He'll pump. Nowhere to go. He's going to run with the football at the 20, and he is hit hard as he lowers his shoulder into a Delaware defender. He is a tough guy. Gets first down yardage out to the 27, but clock running at 104.
He and Pat Kehoe are tough guy quarterbacks, right. Both absorbing some big hits, both big men who run pretty well for their size.
Banks 6'3", 245. Kehoe 6'4", 240. And Banks will throw across the field by Peterson, caught at the 33, and out of bounds he goes, stopping the clock at 47 seconds.
Nice job there by Lars Peterson, the wide receiver to the right, to get himself out of bounds before he touched, or it would have been in, and the clock would have run.
Seven different players catching the football for Cornell. Last week, nine caught passes from Pat Kehoe for Delaware. Second down and four. Delaware leads 14-3. Trips to the left side for Banks, looking that way. Has a man open. It's thrown in that direction, but pass is incomplete as it was knocked away.
Flag on the play.
It was Tenny out of Woosie who got his hand up, but there is a flag on the play.
Personal foul. Late hit number 99. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
It was a pass breakup by Tenny out of Woosie as the ball went into the hands of Garrett Clower, but the penalty against Cam Kitchen is the fourth for Delaware in this game and moves the football closer to midfield for the Big Red.
Cam got there just a little late. He did not take him to the ground. He fell to the ground. I thought that was some pretty good acting there by Dalton Banks. But Kitchen in that situation, it just got to know to pull off and just let it happen. They had a four-man pressure there, pretty well picked up by that veteran line of Cornell.
Negates an excellent play by Tenny Adewusi. First down and 10 at the Cornell 48-yard line. Passes dropped by Peterson on the far side of the field. Would have had about a four-yard pickup before Gray Jones got over to Peterson. Instead, the drop makes it second down and 10, but it does stop the clock at 36 seconds.
Banks showcasing his arm. That's a long throw across the field on a speed out run to field. Boy, if that ball is not thrown properly, that can be a pick six.
Banks with second down and 10 from his own 48. Two wide receivers on both sides for Banks. Pocket closing. Banks stepping up. Gets his footing, throws downfield. Can Brown get under it? No, it falls incomplete. He was looking for Garrett Clower, but Adderley and Brown were the closest players to the football.
Good coverage by Delaware. I think Banks made a great decision there to throw the ball away. He had double coverage. He did a nice job, though, with his physicality of stepping out of a hand. I think it was Cam Kitchen that might have gotten it on him that allowed him to step up into the pocket.
Banks checks with the sideline. 29 seconds left in the first half. 14-3 lead for Delaware. Third down and 10 for Cornell. Cornell just 3 of 9 on third down. Banks takes a shotgun snap. Here comes pressure. Can't avoid it. Caleb Ashworth with the huge sack on the Big Red quarterback.
What a terrific move off the edge. That was a twist stunt. Head goes inside, tackle goes outside, a speed rush completes it. A terrific call there by defensive coordinator Chris Kosh to free up the pass rush.
Delaware not going to call a timeout. They're going to let the first half end with some excitement. Caleb Ashworth, the transfer from Cincinnati, ends the first half with a big sack on the Big Red in a 14-3 lead. Heading into locker room coming up in just a moment. We got an interview with head coach Danny Rocco. This interview presented by Rufo Associates. Visit RufoLaw.com. And Corey Nido awaits head coach Rocco, who's talking to Clint Sinem right now, probably telling him, hey, your defense is looking pretty good right now. And your outside linebacker core that your group is that you're coaching, well, they look all right without Kobe Reeder today as well. Let's send it down to Corey Nido with coach.
All right, thanks, Scott. Coach, your offense has been able to put together two scoring drives at the end of each quarter. How big was that touchdown from Kehoe to go into halftime?
Well, to go up two scores is really huge right now. You know, I credit our defense is playing well. I don't know what we've given up, maybe 100 yards out here. And you had a first drive there for field goal, which is very well scripted on their part, but we responded very well defensively. Offensively, inconsistent, we are getting some shots down the field, and that's an exciting thing to see. But we got to be more positive with more drives. Too many negative drives and opportunities.
Coach, appreciate your time.
Thank you very much.
Scott, back to you.
Thank you very much, Corey. And Coach Rocco, he spotted Cornell 15 yards, only 85 yards of offense for Cornell in that first half. It's a 14-3 lead for Delaware over the Big Red of Cornell. And we are at the half. Coming up, it's the Blue Hens Halftime Report presented by the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers.
Rush hour or relax hour, it's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
Here's your Buick, sir.
Actually, that's my Buick.
Your Buick doesn't have a roof rack. This is my Buick.
How are we gonna fit in your mom's Buick?
Easy.
I like that new Buick.
Me too.
I was actually talking about that Buick.
I knew that.
Did you?
Buick's fresh new lineup is full of surprises. Score big with a new Buick. Current lessees, get this low mileage lease for around $199 per month. Or 18% below MSRP on most Encore models when you finance through GM Financial.
So you guys have recently started dating?
Yes. Yeah. A little less than a month.
Coming up on 2 months now, yeah.
Cool. I want to show you guys these three Chevy SUVs. The first one is called the Trax.
Beautiful.
Do you think it would be good for moving in together?
Moving in together?
Okay. Well, this is the Chevy Equinox.
Wow. Nice.
Perfect for when you two have your first kid.
Give me some time.
Okay. This is the Traverse for when you have your five kids, two dogs, and one cat.
Oh. Five?
Well, no matter what stage of life you're in, Chevy has an SUV for you.
We have it all planned out. Thanks.
Oh, say can you see 2 million bucks?
Lotto America is the new drawing game that's sweeping the nation. Get six numbers right, including the star ball, and you win. And with jackpots starting at $2 million, you win big. Lotto America from the Delaware Lottery. It's the new way to play and win the American dream.
We'll be right back.
tomorrow's man.
Step up to GMC with nearly $11,200 total value on this specially equipped GMC Sierra SLT when you finance through GM Financial.
Vanderbilt currently 16-3, and BYU currently leads number 6 Wisconsin 14-7, and LSU, the number 12 team, over Auburn right now, 12 over 7 right now, 10-7 in that game. Alabama will face Ole Miss, Ohio State and TCU. Washington will face Utah at 10 p.m. And three canceled games from earlier, Virginia Tech and Eastern Carolina, West Virginia, North Carolina States, and UCF and North Carolina, all due to Hurricane Florence. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we will have the recap of the first half. The Hens currently leading Cornell at the half, 14-3. We have your highlights coming up after the break.
When you find yourself in need of legal advice, you need a lawyer that will sit down.
BEW Local 313 Halftime Show. Benny Pinella in the studio, Scott Klatsch and Bill Harmon live at the scene of a 14-3 Delaware lead heading into halftime. One other CA scoring update. This one just getting into halftime right now. Villanova has scored a touchdown, so Towson still leading them by a score of 35-21. All right, Delaware, they donned their blue and gold uniforms for the gold outs in today's game, and they are 1-1 in the all-blue so far this season. The Hens, they would win the coin toss into first, so we'll see this UD defense to start. From the 25 to start, Cornell gets assistance from a pass interference on Tenny Adewusi to pick up a first down against UD to the 35-yard line. Three plays later, Harold Coles would rip a 19-yard run to bring the Big Red to the Blue Hens territory. Two plays after that, on third and three, Cornell gets their third first down on a 4-yard completion from Dalton Banks to Coles to the UD 28. So this UD defense early on not looking like their old self. One play later on second and six, Cornell into the red zone on a 10-yard J.D. Pickell run to the Blue Hen 14. Delaware hasn't allowed a score in the last five quarters. That streak would end on this drive.
And this is going to be a 28-yard field goal try from about the center of the field with 9:05 left in the first quarter. Kick is up, and Cornell, after a 12-play drive, takes a 3-0 lead. That's your Blue Hens Radio timeout score with 9 minutes left in the first. We'll be back in just a moment.
8:55 left in the first. UD down 3-0, trailing for the first time since week one versus Rhode Island on a 13-play, 64-yard drive for Cornell. The Hens would take over on their own 17. Delaware not looking like their old selves. Very quick three and out. UD only picking up 4 yards following the long Big Red scoring drive. We'll skip ahead to 2:56 left in the first. The Big Red and UD trading punts for punts. They would do that on their next two drives apiece. So in the first quarter, a good Papali return would be nullified on a block in the back. That punt would have waved off Cornell possibly They were lined up illegal in an illegal formation on that punt, but no call. UD would take over at their 22. After a rough start, the Hens start to get moving. Kehoe would connect on a four straight for 51 yards and 13 on a DeJohn Lee burst. They would add 13 on a DeJohn Lee burst, and after totaling just negative 5 yards, 64 yards on six plays, sees UD at the 14 of Cornell, and on second and 10, they would see themselves with the lead.
Second down and 10. From the Cornell 14-yard line, two wide receivers to the near side. It's Jarman and Walker. Kehoe dropping back. Blitz coming. Lobbing to the end zone. Walker leaps to grab it. Six for Joe Walker.
The blitz.
A big touchdown there for the University of Delaware. 7-3 lead, taking the lead after a rough start. Delaware also taking momentum into the second quarter. Cornell takes over at their 23, looking to answer on the road. However, Delaware's defense has no questions. Two straight Cornell drives, ending with three and outs to this point. I'll make it three in a row. 12:47, out comes Delaware, looking to stay hot. On third and five from the 23, Pat Kehoe would connect with Charles Scarf for a 9-yard connection and a first to the Cornell 32. UD would get three more, but this big red pass rush for the second time today would reach Pat Kehoe, and Delaware's drive would end with a punt. 10:03 from the 25, Dalton Banks out, Richie Kenny in. Cornell's shuffling the deck a little bit and seeing results. After two plays on third and eight, Kenny finds Fitzgerald for a first down. That bizarre switch. So out would come Kenny. We'd see a third quarterback, Mike Katniss. He would promptly get sacked, and then Richie Kenny would re-enter the game. And don't ask me. He would complete one pass, and he also wouldn't get the first down. That would be a perplexing drive that would end in a punt for Cornell. 7:19, here comes UD from the 17. Kehoe completes a 42-yarder to Joe Walker. Big game for Joe Walker. Then two Kanaike runs would pick up 13. But as quick as this drive begun, Delaware's drive would end in a missed field goal at Cornell's 28 by Frank Rago. UD still with a 7-3 lead. 5:23 left. The Big Red trying to rally, but Delaware's dominating defense once again. The fourth three and out of the day for Cornell. 3:40 back to UD from the 25. Kehoe would scamper for 6 yards, and a play later would complete an 8-yarder to Walker. Joe Walker, the QB turned wide receiver, really turned playmaker, having a huge day. It gets better. Kehoe to Walker again, connecting for 39 yards. Joe Walker, 4 catches, 103 yards, and a score in the half, having a monster game. And then Delaware at the Cornell 20, a pass interference penalty gets UD to the 5. And then, well, in the next play, it would also get UD 6.
Now Lee out of the backfield. Empty backfield for Kehoe. Trips to the right side. Kehoe gets the snap. Keeps it himself. Tucks, runs, scores. Pat Kehoe.
Big play for Pat Kehoe. 7 plays, 75 yards, 14-3. The lead for Delaware, an 11-point lead with 1:31 left in the half. Cornell, well, they would try to utilize the new kickoff touchback rule, but a penalty would back them up to the 12-yard line. Dalton Banks back in. He'd get a single first down, but then nothing more. 14-3, the lead for Delaware as they take that into the half, and they will, of course, get the ball coming out of it as we send it back to Scott Klatskin and Bill Harmon live from Delaware Stadium. Again, Delaware dominating the Big Red 14-3.
This has been the Blue Hens Halftime Report, presented by the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers Local 313 and its local contractors. We'll be right back with the start of the second half from the ValueDaysFuel.com broadcast booth, right here on 94.7 WDSD and iHeartRadio.
Cheer on the Blue Hens wearing all the newest blue and gold gear from the Barnes & Noble UD Bookstore in Newark, the official bookstore of the University of Delaware. Online at shopbluehens.com.
Your local Chevy dealers and the Delaware Blue Hens are both.
rush hour, or relax hour. It's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
Here's your Buick, sir.
Actually, that's my Buick.
Your Buick doesn't have a roof rack. This is my Buick.
How are we gonna fit in your mom's Buick?
Easy.
I like that new Buick.
Me too.
I was actually talking about that Buick.
I knew that.
Did you?
Buick's fresh new lineup is full of surprises. Score big with a new Buick. Current lessees get this low mileage lease for around $199 per month. Or 18% below MSRP on most Encore models when you finance through GM Financial.
Oh, say can you see 2 million bucks?
Lotto America is the new drawing game that's sweeping the nation. Get 6 numbers right, including the star ball, and you win. And with jackpots starting at $2 million, you win big. Lotto America from the Delaware Lottery. It's the new way to play and win the American dream.
Delaware for 12-25. The Hens 2 of 6 on third down. Cornell 3 of 10 on third down. Neither team has gone for it on fourth, and each team has scored in the red zone. Delaware 2 of 2 with 2 touchdowns. Cornell 1 of 1 with a field goal. That drive started the football game. Individually, Harold Coles has 31 yards rushing to lead Cornell. 24 yards for Kenai Kane leads Delaware. 15 yards for Dejon Lee, 13 of them for a first down run on his first carry. And Pat Kehoe, he lost 19 on a sack, so a net of 1, but he's gained 20 yards, including 5 on a touchdown run, the only rushing touchdown of the day. Throwing the football, he's 8 of 18 is Kehoe, 1 touchdown. He was sacked twice, a long of 42. That went to Joe Walker, his favorite target of the day, 103 yards for Joe Walker, including a 14-yard touchdown catch. 42 the long, 2 catches for Papali. Scarf has 1, Tyler has 1, both for 9 yards. Dalton Banks has thrown the ball 6 of 12 for Cornell, just 20 yards. He was sacked once. Richie Kenny is 3 of 5, and Mike Katniss we've seen as well. He has not gotten a pass attempt off. Lars Peterson and Harold Coles both have caught 2 passes for Cornell. Busy day for Nicholas Null, who's punted 5 times, averaging 45.4 per punt. Nick Pritchard 3 times for Delaware's punter, 48 on the average, along of 53. Defensively, McClurge has 4 tackles from the cornerback position for the Big Red. Lance Glass has 3 tackles, including 1 sack. For Delaware, Malcolm Brown, 9 tackles in the first half. He had 10 coming into this game on the season. 6 for Charles Bell, Adderley with 4, Troy Reeder with 4 to lead Delaware. Sacks by Armin Ware and Caleb Ashworth. And Bill, what stands out to you looking at those first half stats?
Well, what I love was the defensive team's adjustment after the first drive. Only 21 yards since that 64-yard drive to start the game with Cornell kicking the field goal. We talked about Cornell, 3 quarterbacks already, pretty unusual for that, and 5 running backs. Though, interestingly enough, their star running back coming back from an ACL, they've only used him at wide receiver. Chris Walker has not been in the backfield yet, at least for a carry. I like the adjustments by Chris Kosh and the defensive staff. I like the fact that Matt Simon's willing to have Pat Kehoe throw the ball down the field. That's going to open us up for big plays later on. We're getting Walker involved a lot more down the field in the vertical stretch mode, and that's what he's really good at. And I continue to like the use of the running backs right now, Kane and Lee, but also putting Pat Kehoe into the run game, especially with that quarterback draw in the red zone. A really savvy call by Matt.
A Star Health Star Watch update presented by Star Health, a new direction in healthcare. Chris Walker, he was our Star Health Star Watch player for Cornell. We expected him to return to All Ivy 2016. And you mentioned, Bill, we haven't seen much of him. Muddle huddle to start the second half for Cornell as they've got all of their players bunched at the 30-yard line with Nicholas Knoll leading the way to kick this one away. And now they break. And in fact, it's Zach Mays who will handle kickoff duties. Delaware won the toss. They deferred to the second half, so they'll get the football first. Dejon Lee and Vinny Papali back to return. Cornell kicking towards the student section in that south end zone. Ball is in the air and could be returnable for Lee. About 2 yards deep in the end zone, he'll bring it out with a running start. The 10 has a blocker at the 15-yard line. Contact there. Dives ahead to the 20-yard line, and that's where Delaware will start the second half of football with a 14-3 lead, and Pat Kehoe out on the field to run the offense.
I know Coach Rocco in his comments to Coronado on the sideline as he left the field talked about maybe being a little inconsistent. Well, part of the problem was, as you alluded to with the statistics, was the time of possession. Cornell was 17 minutes and 35 seconds. It's hard to get in rhythm, though what I like about it is Delaware's made some big plays. We just need to protect Pat a little bit more and get Kane going in the run game.
And remember, Delaware's first two possessions, three and out before they got their offense going. First and 10 for Delaware. In the slot is Owen Tyler. And Tyler will get the pass at the 20, caught, and he slips at around the 22, trying to turn upfield. There on the stop was Colby McGowan.
After stretching the field vertically, coming up early on to build Pat's confidence coming out of the halftime, a nice throw to Owen Tyler in the left flat. Owen Tyler really impresses me. They use him in motion. They use him as a setback. He sometimes shuffle motions, great at the point of attack, but really becoming a nice possession receiver.
Versatile player, missed all of last season with a shoulder injury. Picked up three there, second and seven from the Hens 23-yard line. First possession of the second half, and Kehoe will keep it. Throwing, looking for Jarman. Jarman can't get under it. Jones has done well against Jarman, step for step on that pass near midfield. That's the fifth target for Jamie Jarman, no catches.
Well, they really like Jones. They claim McCure is even a better cornerback. I like Jones. He's physical. He's a junior from Sugarland, Texas, played a lot of spread football down there. I'm sure he's faced a lot of really good receivers. Jarman just and Kehoe just a little off in their timing, but I like the fact that Kehoe keeps looking to him. We need to target Jamie and get him a little bit more involved in the pass offense.
Last time Jones was on the field, he had three interceptions against Penn in the final game of 2017. Third and seven for Delaware from their own 23. Kehoe is hit but gets the pass away to Jarman, who slips across the 35 and gets first down at yardage. I thought that was for sure going to be a fumble. It looked like Kehoe's arm was hit but somehow powered through the throw.
Well, that's the strength of Kehoe, but he held the ball just long enough to allow Jarman to come from right to left in that crossing pattern. Caught the ball about 6 yards down the field and then completes the run. Good timing on those underneath routes and a good job by Kehoe hanging in the pocket.
First catch of the day for Jamie Jarman, sixth of the season. And we'll see Kenai Kane running to the 40 and diving over a tackler at the 44-yard line. And a busy second half so far for Colt McGowan, his second tackle of third quarter.
Well, Colby McGowan did exactly what anybody would have done there with Kane coming downhill. He makes what we call that diving tackle. It's almost a block tackle. It's not a courageous play. He's got to go in and take on a 240-pound plus running back coming downhill with full speed. A pretty nice play by the cornerback from Cornell.
Easier for us to say up here in the booth, Bill. Here comes Kane. Let's see who stands in front of him this time at the 45-yard line. It takes several white jerseys to bring him down. In fact, after contact at the 45, he might have got an extra yard up to the 46, setting up third down and maybe a yard for a Delaware.
Nice block there by the pulling right guard, Mario Farinelli. He did a great job there of getting his hips in the hole. Kane does such a wonderful job after the first contact of keeping his pad level low and keeping those big legs moving.
Third down and a yard for Delaware at their own 46-yard line, a 14-3 lead, 12:30. Third quarter action. Cornell showing pressure up the middle. They turn, give to Kane. He plows for first down yardage into Cornell territory at the 47-yard line. It was Jelani Taylor who made the stop.
Cornell had 10 players within 4 yards of the line of scrimmage and the box. And Kane did a nice job there of bouncing that inside zone play outside to again get his shoulder square. He's really getting good at that. It's not a true jump cut like Dejon Lee has, but I'll tell you what, for a big man, he moves his hips extremely well.
We're going to see Kareem Williams, I believe, for the first time this season as the Hens will go into Wildcat. Joe Walker will take the snap and Spruill to his right. Joe Walker keeps it, turns upfield and gets to the 41-yard line. Down the field goes Walker, and Maxwell McCormick made the stop. So a Wildcat, we saw that once against Rhode Island. There was a bad snap, hadn't seen it since. And Joe Walker gets 6 yards on his first carry of the day.
There's the improvement of Colin Wallace, the center, doing a much better job of connecting with different quarterback back there. And Joe Walker, he's doing a great job of blocking at the point of attack. A real improvement there by Colin Wallace.
Pistol formation for Kehoe on second down and 4 from the Cornell 41. Kane got it, bounces to the outside, and can't get past Victor Olapinson, the senior from New Jersey, who held him up just long enough for some other helpers to get over.
And that's one of those times where, as a defensive team, if you can make a big runner like Kane have to bounce, you have the ability possibly to stop him. But once Kane gets his pad level down, Hill, he's very difficult to stop for anything less than 3 or 4 yards.
10 carries for Kane thus far, 37 yards rushing. He's averaging 80 yards per game. Had that 100-yard game against Rhode Island in the opener. Third down at 7. Two wide receivers to both sides for Pat Kehoe, who will go in shotgun form with Kane to his left. Scarf and Jarman to his left. Papali and Walker to his right. Kehoe clapping for the football. Play clock at 2, now 1. Kehoe gets the snap. Pressure coming. Tries to step up. Flings it to an offensive lineman who catches the football. It's David Kroll as he goes down at the 44, but a flag is thrown.
Catches the ball to 72. David Kroll, flag on the play.
Flag was thrown as Kehoe was throwing the football, and the officiating crew will get together.
Well, the lineman cannot catch the ball, first of all.
Yeah. Again, our friend Eric Lewis taking his time.
He's had a lot of work today, Scott.
His mic pack. He likes the attention, I believe. Here we go.
Holding. Offense, number 71. That penalty is declined. Intentional grounding on the offense. That's a spot foul, loss of down. Fourth down. Hey, spot.
And so you hear double fouls against Delaware. The potential grounding is because, as you mentioned, as fun as it was to see David Kroll with the football in his hand, he's not able to catch the football.
And there was no other eligible receiver in the vicinity. That was a nice call there by the Cornell defensive staff. Jelani Taylor from a safety blitz from Delaware's left side just came through unblocked and made the play on Kehoe.
And now a stoppage as
they're going to have too many men on the field, Will Cornell.
Illegal substitution, defense number 3, 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
It was 4th and 14 because of the penalty, so Nick Pritchard will move up, but Delaware will have to punt the football. So it moves from the Delaware 49-yard line to the Cornell 46.
This will be fun to watch Pritchard kick. He's very skilled at the rugby-type kick, having it almost like a sandwich backspin. He also can kick it old-fashioned style coffin corner, so he's very versatile in these situations.
He has been a weapon in his 1 year with Delaware thus far. This one high, and Jones going to let it bounce. It rolls, and Delaware's special teams unit is there. It stops at about the 8.5-yard line. Tani Adewusi was there just as he was a week ago to down the football. And Delaware leads it 14-3. Change of possession, 10-13, third quarter. We'll take a timeout on the Blue Hens Sports Radio Network.
Come experience a new direction in healthcare. Star Health at the University of Delaware, offering the health services you need to stay
well. So you guys have recently started dating?
Yes.
Yeah. A little less than a month.
Coming up on 2 months now, yeah.
Cool. I want to show you guys these 3 Chevy SUVs. The first one is called the Trax.
Beautiful.
Do you think it would be good for moving in together?
Moving in together?
Okay. Well, this is the Chevy Equinox.
Wow.
Nice.
Perfect for when you 2 have your first kid.
Give me some time.
Okay. This is the Traverse for when you have your 5 kids, 2 dogs, and 1 cat.
Oh. 5?
Well, no matter what stage of life you're in, Chevy has an SUV for you.
We have it all planned out. Thanks. It's here!
Here comes the man.
Step up to GMC with nearly 11,200 total value on this specially equipped GMC Sierra SLT when you finance through GM Financial.
easy to love. With tax-free shopping and lots of free parking, visit peoplesplaza.com. Cornell on the field to start this drive. First and 10. Banks throws, turns, and the catch is made. But Ray Jones lights up the wide receiver at the 16-yard line. Nice job of holding onto the football. Having Buck in your area, Devin Cross with the catch.
Nice little sit-down route there, called out of the timeout by Cornell. Banks very good at the short throws. Little play action fake freed the receiver up.
Second down and 2, an 8-yard pickup for Cross. And Cam Kitchen with a tackle for loss as they gave the ball to the running back. It was S.K. Howard, and he gets dropped at the 16. I guess he got to the line of scrimmage there, but nice job by Cam Kitchen, who we were impressed with a week ago.
Kitchen plays with such great pad level. He's got very quick and active hands. He's got a low center of gravity, getting healthier every day. I really like the way he plays. Caleb Ashworth really complimenting him in there, Scott, as he skimmed over to help.
Third down and a yard for Cornell. Banks goes under center. In motion goes to tight end. He retraces. Banks going to keep it. Troy Reeder jumping on top of the quarterback, but I think he got enough. What an effort by the Delaware defense there.
Troy Reeder showing those, what shall I call, an old man legs at 24. Jumping. He is such a terrific athlete. I mean, he was a wonderful lacrosse player as well. In high school, he could have played basketball and others. Just a wonderful athlete who does a lot of really subtle things out on the field that, unless you get a chance to watch him live or have tape on him, he's an extraordinary athlete.
Showed it there with a leaping ability, but just could not stop Banks as he got enough for the first down. First and 10. From the Cornell 19, in motion goes Pickell. The sweep, they go to Pickell, and he is rocked by Buck Jones at the 20-yard line. Ray Jones is coming out and hitting hard in this third quarter.
Ray Jones coming from that banded position, that outside linebacker hybrid strong safety spot. That's a play that Cornell ran in the first half, a jet sweep to field. That time he was in perfect position to make the tackle. Looked like a TFL to me right at the line of scrimmage. I guess they gave him about a half a yard.
Five tackles, four solo today for Buck Jones. Think he's having fun playing linebacker? He looks like it. Second down and 9 for the Cornell 20. Man in motion is Thomas Glover. Banks pumps to him. Will throw downfield. If Brown turned around, he would have a pick. Instead, it's a completed pass to the tight end Fitzgerald at the 35-yard line. And first down pickup for the Big Red.
Well, Banks wanted to take a shot down the field, but great coverage by Nigel Hill on the wide out to his side. He had to abandon that, brought his eyes down. A pretty nice throw there by Banks to the wide side of the field.
Don Banks is 8 of 14 for 43 yards in this game. The starting quarterback threw for almost 250 yards last season against Delaware. Bunch trips to the far side right for Banks on first and 10. Give is to S.K. Howard. He has a hole at midfield. A shimmy move at the 45. Spins off of Adderley, and down he goes at the 40-yard line. If Adderley doesn't stick his left hand out, S.K. Howard has a 65-yard touchdown. Instead, Cornell moves the football into Hens territory.
Delaware's front got a little too far up the field, and a nice little trapping action on the left side. Sprung S.K. Howard, who has good speed. I think had he not decided to try to boogie his feet a little bit and cut, he might have been better off just running straight to the goal line, but a nice play downfield.
15-yard pass to the tight end and a 25-yard run on back-to-back plays. Now Pickell gets a screen pass at the 40-yard line down to the 36, and Cornell moving the football a bit here in the second half.
I've been impressed with J.D. Pickell, the senior who was injured last year and missed 8 games. He's an active runner after the catch. He's got good hands, runs nice patterns for Banks.
Derdarian in the game at the running back position, the sophomore. Saw him once in the first half, and Cornell rotating about 5 or 6 running backs in this game. Pumping is Banks, and he throws it up for grabs as Frank Burton almost got his 4th sack of the season. Adewusi was in coverage, and Banks had nothing that he could do.
Adewusi with really nice coverage down the field. The pump fake did not bother him. That shows you how well coached Adewusi has become and his understanding of what they were trying to do to him.
And my apologies, Mike Katniss was in the game. I got my eyes on all these different running backs. I was surprised to see a new quarterback pop up mid-drive after Banks throws for 40 yards in 2 plays. It's 3rd down and 6 from the Delaware 36-yard line. The Hens up 11. And it'll
It'll be Banks keeping himself. Nowhere to go. Frank Burton slows him up. And Banks gets down to the 32-yard line, but had to get to the 30 for a first down. It'll be fourth and close. Decision time for David Archer.
That's a play out of Rhode Island's playbook. In game one, Frank Burton got his shoulders turned and didn't play it correctly. That time, learning from the tape, learning from coaching, he was in perfect position to bring the quarterback down on a belly read.
And we're learning quickly. Jawan Lawson, the quarterback for Rhode Island, a little bit different to contain than some of these other quarterbacks. He's a CAA Player of the Week. Team will stay on the field. They went for it 24 times a year ago, did Cornell. It's fourth and three. Ball on the 33-yard line of Delaware. Crowd making some noise. Fitzgerald in motion. Banks keeps. Hit hard by Troy Reeder, and he should be shy of that 30-yard line. A turnover on down.
They bring Bell on a blitz to the right side. That blows up the initial play, which was going to be a belly read that forced Banks to keep it. Troy Reeder with a big-time downhill attack and making a tackle on a big runner at 245 pounds to bring him down short.
Quickly, let's send it down to the sideline, and Corey Knight, who had an eye on that play.
Yeah, Scott, Troy just absolutely read that play perfectly, didn't bite on the option, and as we said, he's a ball hawk, and he swarms the ball carrier. He did exactly that for that huge fourth down stop.
Delaware's offense onto the field, first and 10 from their own 31-yard line. Dejon Lee is the running back. Kane got the first set in the third quarter. Turnover on downs happening at 5:28. Kehoe will keep it on the RPO and run up to the 35-yard line. A gain of four, up by 11. And Pat Kehoe making wise decisions on these run-pass options.
Boy, I really like the concept of putting Pat Kehoe in the offensive run game. They're running him on smart little quarterback counters. Chuka had a great pull there, though he didn't even block anyone. He was in the way, and that forced the defense to adjust. First down, five-yard type plays are great to get your offense going.
Absolutely. It's second down and five from their own 36. I form Tyler and Dejon Lee behind Kehoe. Play action. Kehoe has some time and an open man. It's Charles Scarf in Cornell territory at the 42.
Scott, it's so hard to believe how wide open Charles Scarf gets at times. He's a good pattern runner. We talk about his size. Obviously not slow because he gets the ability to outrun cornerbacks, but that time he had created separation with a nice little head fake, and Pat Kehoe with plenty of time to survey the situation delivers a perfect ball.
Coach Rocco telling me this week, Charles Scarf is just now noticing how good of a player he can be, and we are noticing it. Watching him play his second catch today. First and 10 in Cornell territory at the 42 for Delaware. Dejon Lee trying to get to the outside, runs into his own offensive lineman, thrown, slowed down there, and gets back to the line of scrimmage. It'll be second down and 10.
Scott, I didn't have a lot of opportunities to watch Boyle, who's now with the Ravens. Would you compare them?
He's a Charles Scarf part of their career? Doesn't jump over as many defenders as Nick Boyle loved to do, but in terms of the catch radius and the size, you're looking at a guy that if he has an excellent and continues his pace as a senior, some eyes at the NFL level are going to look at Charles
Scarf. I love his dimensions. That's what I find so intriguing about Scarf.
Absolutely. Two catches today for 31 yards, and the sweep is going to go to Jamie Jarman on second down to the outside near the sideline. First down yarded down at the 30-yard line. Malcolm Chaka bringing down Jamie Jarman. I love how in this second half we have seen Joe Walker get the football on a wild count of Jamie Jarman, some different ways of integrating our guys.
Keeping the defense off balance, keeping that box a little bit cleaner. We talked earlier on in the season about Joe Walker running some of those speed sweeps. Using Jarman is also a wonderful move. He's very quick. He was a fantastic runner in high school, has great vision and knows when to cut up the field. Good decision maker.
Two tight ends to the right of Pat Kehoe, first and 10 at the Cornell 31. Gene Coleman in the slot. And the give is to Dejon Lee to the outside. Can he get to the edge? A stiff arm gets him to the 30-yard line and out of bounds by Reese Sagerbush, the captain with the tackle there. And Cornell has done a fairly good job with stopping the run in this game. All things considered, Lee averaging 8.6 yards per carry normally, now down to 4 in this contest.
Well, it's been the ability of Cornell to stack the box and to get away with it at times. They did a good job there of flowing to the outside. A really effective and physical straight arm there. Stiff arm as it is by Dejon Lee. I can't believe how physical he is. He's got great dimensions for that leverage underneath.
Same formation flipped with two tight ends to the left this time. Coleman in the slot and Kehoe pumping, stepping up, running at the 30 and
A full head of steam down to the 22-yard line, diving close to the first down marker. I believe he's going to be a yard shy. And a tackle made by Segebruch again. It'll be third down and 1.5, perhaps.
Big-time pressure off Kehoe's left side. He did a marvelous job of tucking the football. A lot of quarterbacks will get it exposed. He did a great job of bringing it down and then running. Kehoe really making some wise decisions in the backfield against pressure.
Big Kenai Kane in on third down and one in the pistol. He stands behind Pat Kehoe from the Cornell 22. Delaware up 11. Kane gets the give and lowers his shoulder for a first down at the 20-yard line. It was Segebruch again, but not before Kane got the yard they needed.
That's big-time football, big-boy football as well. Mario Farinella doing a nice job of pulling from his right guard on just a basic power play. Kane with low pads, well blocked at the point of attack, even though Cornell had an extra defender there. That's one on the grease board you draw up and you think it's not supposed to work, but it did because of a fine block and really good ball carrying by Kane.
Under center goes Kehoe. 14-3. Delaware leads, 1:15 remaining in the third quarter. 49 yards on 7 plays on this drive. And a whistle, a flag on the play. And I believe Delaware got started early. There was a lot of movement on the line on both sides, but Delaware might have been first.
False start, snap infraction, 71 offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Again, we see Colin Wallace. We know the problems that Delaware had in week one with the snaps. This time, a penalty against the center.
I want to credit Jared Backus, the defensive coordinator of Cornell. The Cornell defensive front does a lot of stemming. That means they move their front around once, twice, sometimes three times during the play clock if the quarterback's checking with his sideline. So that can cause some confusion.
Kenai Kane is a single back on first and 15 after the penalty. Kehoe on the slant, has Walker, his fifth catch, down to the 15-yard line. Ball comes loose late. He was down. Cornell got the football, but Walker was down at the 15. A gain of 10. It'll be second down and 5, getting some of that penalty yardage back plus more.
What a nice correction by Pat Kehoe. On the last slant run by Jarman in the first half, he threw the ball a little behind. I think it was obscure. That time, he had his front foot, his right foot, because he's a lefty, lined up exactly where he wanted to throw it, delivers a perfect pass. And boy, once Delaware can run those slants against this man coverage, it's going to open up a lot of opportunities.
Kehoe, 12 of 24, over 200 yards for the third straight game to start his career as the quarterback. Hens going to let the third quarter clock wind down. That's the final play of the third. Fourth quarter action coming up on 94.7 WDSD with the score, Blue Hens 14, Big Red 3.
Stop stopping.
Here's your Buick, sir.
Actually, that's my Buick.
Your Buick doesn't have a roof rack. This is my Buick.
How are we gonna fit in your mom's Buick?
Easy.
I like that new Buick.
Me too.
I was actually talking about that Buick.
I knew that.
Did you?
Buick's fresh new lineup is full of surprises. Score big with a new Buick. Current lessees get this low mileage lease for around $199 per month. Or 18% below MSRP on most Encore models when you finance through GM Financial.
So you guys have recently started dating?
Yes.
A little less than a month.
Coming up on 2 months now, yeah.
Cool. I want to show you guys these three Chevy SUVs. The first one is called the Trax.
Beautiful.
Do you think it would be good for moving in together?
Moving in together?
Okay. Well, this is the Chevy Equinox.
Wow. Nice.
Perfect for when you two have your first kid.
Yeah, give me some time.
Okay. This is the Traverse for when you have your five kids, two dogs, and one cat.
Oh.
Five?
Well, no matter what stage of life you're in, Chevy has an SUV for you.
We have it all planned out, thanks.
Behind him is Kenai Kane. The tight end is Charles Scarf on second down and five from the Cornell 15-yard line. Kehoe under center. The quarterback turns, gives to Kane, bounces to the left side, and sworn by the Cornell defense. He gets to the line of scrimmage, maybe lost one, back to the 16.
Delaware trying to assert their run game. Now they'll go with four wides. What I like there about Pat Kehoe is he continues to mature and understand the way to play that position, especially in big moments like this in the red zone. A couple of really good hard counts. Did not draw Cornell off, but I like the fact that he's varying his cadence.
Andre Robinson, the running back from Penn State, is in the game. On third down and five, he'll stand next to Pat Kehoe. Dejon Lee is in the slot on the right side of the field. Third and five from the 15. Lee in motion. Kehoe gets the snap. Kehoe keeps it. Pull up the middle of the field. Head down. First down. Delaware moves the chain.
When you fake the speed sweep with a player like Lee, who's so quick, your defense has to move a little bit in that direction. That opens up the keep by Kehoe, who I love his decision making. He can either hand that off or keep it himself. He's reading inside. That time he made the perfect decision.
First down, goal to go from the five. Last time Delaware had a goal to go situation from the five, Pat Kehoe rushed it in. This time Kane stands behind him as a single back. Jarman to the right of Kehoe. To the left is Joe Walker. Delaware up 14-3. In motion goes Jarman. Kehoe gives to Kane. Kane, contact at the five, powering down to the 3-yard line. And Race Sagerbrush came in first for the stop.
Boy, a nice twist there by Matt Simon and Billy Polian, the offensive line coach. That was a heavy formation to the left outside of our left tackle. David Kroll was our right tackle, Nota Bay, and then the tight end, Owen Tyler. So we were heavy in that direction. That really forces the defense to either angle that way or get an extra defender there. A nice call.
Three to the left side of Kehoe, who's clapping for it. Pistol formation, second down, goal to go from the three. In motion again is Jarman. Kane again, pushing, spinning, scoring. Flex those muscles, Kenai Kane. You just gave the Hens a 20-3 lead.
Another really fine call in the red zone with the run game. That heavy set to the left, it's unbalanced. They then pull Bay back to the right side. He throws a great block to free Kane up for the finish.
He is a hard man to tackle, and he puts that head down, and you've got a 3 yards before 6 points. A 20-3 lead for Kenai Kane and the Blue Hens. A 12-play, 69-yard drive that took up 7:41. Of the clock. It started in the third and now 12:47 left in the fourth. Frank Rago gets the extra point through. 21-3. That's your Blue Hens Radio timeout score as we take a break on 94.7 FM.
Oh, say can you see 2 million bucks?
Lotto America is the new drawing game that's sweeping the nation. Get 6 numbers right, including the star ball, and you win. And with jackpots starting at $2 million, you win big. Lotto America from the Delaware Lottery. It's the new way to play and win the American dream.
October 27th from noon until 3. People's Plaza, located in...
It's here!
Here comes the man.
Step up to GMC with nearly 11,200 total value on this specially equipped GMC Sierra SLT when you finance through GM Financial.
9 yards on 12 plays, and it ends with a Kenai Kane rushing touchdown. from 3 yards out, his second touchdown of this season, putting Delaware up 21-3. And Roth kicking this one away, usually unreturnable. He has a school record for most touchbacks, and it's only his second season on the team. And Corey Nido, you're down on the sideline, and you've got a close-up look of the growth of Pat Kehoe in this offense.
Absolutely, Scott. Pat has looked so confident here today against Cornell. Not only is he making checks and fixing plays and directing his players, but he's also making the reads, as Bill mentioned, on the other side of the break on the RPOs, where he's reading the defense, seeing that there's a big hole up the middle, so he's keeping it, and he just continues to mature on a week-to-week basis. But I would say today is definitely the most that he's seen, the most comfortable running this offense, Scott.
And Coach said that was one of the reasons he won that starting position, was he is the best fit in this offense. 12 of 24 today, 203, three straight games with over 200 yards, and Kehoe's 279 last week, the most since Trent Hurley threw for 295 against James Madison in 2014. And I'm sure the next time a Delaware quarterback throws for high numbers, it'll be the most since whenever, because Delaware, we know for the past 3 years, has been at the bottom of the barrel in the FCS in terms of throwing the football. Nice to have a balanced offense this year, up 21-3. There's a stoppage on the field, which lets me remind our listeners that when football is on, you have to be at Buffalo Wild Wings. $5 game day pitchers of Bud Light, Coors Light, and Miller Light, and $5 cocktails, cheeseburgers, and brats. Prices and participation may vary. 12:47 remaining in this contest, 21-3. The Blue Hens are up. And how about this Delaware defense, who now through seven quarters and some change have allowed just 3 points? And absolutely incredible. You go back to that first week, the first score was on special teams, so you got to take six or seven off the board in that Rhode Island game. They've been absolutely valuable and one of the top FCS defenses in the country.
It all starts with the coaching, in my opinion. Obviously, you've got to have great players, and we do. But the Delaware staff does a great job of coordinating this. This has been a great opportunity this afternoon to get a lot of valuable reserves in, to get extra minutes. So we see for the first time Artis Hemingway in. And I think Brandon Hall's done a nice job today playing that defensive end position as well. So Morrow playing with that bad arm, but he gives it his best every time.
Banks going to tuck and run, but not run far, as Buchanan stripped him of the football. He was going to be marked down at the 27-yard line. Cornell picked up the football as well. Buchanan had a big play earlier in this contest, interception last week, and the true freshman from Brick, New Jersey, showing that the future is bright in that linebacker position.
He had 275 tackles in high school over two seasons. I mean, that is unbelievable, because you're not probably playing more than 12 games unless you went super deep into the playoffs. He is very active and extremely quick.
He was everywhere. Second down and 8 for the Cornell 27. Banks going to put it eventually into the chest of Harold Coles. Looks like Banks was holding on, looking at his option, and Coles was running, and Banks still had one hand on the football.
Well, that's because Sal Morrow did a terrific job at his defensive end position, keeping his shoulder square, playing right down the line of scrimmage. That's who Banks is reading on that play to decide whether to give the ball off or keep it himself, and he couldn't because Morrow played it so well.
Cavado, good to see him back. Hemingway both in on the tackle for Delaware. Third down and 7 for Cornell. 11:35, fourth quarter, 21-3. Delaware on top, trips to the right side for Banks. Here comes pressure from Adewusi. Banks gets the throw off. The catch is made by Gauman. He's wrapped up by Troy Reeder, but his second effort of falling forward got the first down for Cornell.
Another one of those freshmen who got the start today because of Colby Reeder's injury. Drew Nichols did a wonderful job there of lancing in from his right end position with a nice quick swim move to get pressure on Banks, who did a nice job of hanging in there and releasing the ball at the right moment.
They like Goldman, who just caught the football. A sophomore, started as a freshman last year, injured with a foot injury a season ago. First and 10 for Banks. All day to throw. Up for grabs. Tipped incomplete. It was high, looking for Nick Canal, the tight end, and there is a flag back at the 35-yard line. More flags than I think either team would like in this contest.
Neither team gets penalized a lot. Cornell about 6 times last year, and Delaware usually around 4.
Waiting on Eric Lewis. Come on, buddy. All day, he's been moseying along.
Ineligible receiver downfield, number 40. 5-yard penalty, first down.
I've never seen a referee take longer to announce the penalty.
Almost like a Supreme Court decision.
He's just,
Ruth Bader Ginsburg graduated Cornell in 1954.
Well, there you go.
Jan Arino, Attorney General in 1960. So a lot of adjudicators over there from Cornell.
Maybe it's an ode to the Big Red. Certainly a great college out of the Ivy League, University out of the Ivy League. Dalton Banks going to throw. Screen pass is caught at the 30-yard line there to make the stop. Ray Jones and Malcolm Brown. Brown, 11 tackles on the day as they got up to almost where they started, the 34-yard line.
Talk about textwork tackling. Unbelievable job by both Brown to have perfect angles there. They run their feet. Jones in perfect position, balancing up, just nowhere for the runner to go. Really good coaching there by the Delaware defensive backfield staff.
A lot of substitutions. Austin Gray in the game. Drew Nichols in the game. Nichols getting to the quarterback. So does Troy Reeder. Sack. Flag is thrown. Troy Reeder brought him down.
And I think that's going to be hold on Drew Nichols again with a wonderful pass rush move to the outside.
Holding. Number 70 on the offense. Penalty is declined. Third down.
And that was the offensive lineman grabbing onto Drew Nichols, who I thought had a better beat to the quarterback than Troy Reeder did. Starting 22, though, after the sack. Troy Reeder, Drew Nichols, Johnny Buchanan, Charles Bell set the tone for the linebacker position. Ray Jones has had some big hits. What a fun linebacking core this is to watch, and the depth they have, thanks to a couple of true freshmen. Third down and 22. Ball on the Cornell 24, and Banks out of shotgun form. Banks 10 of 16 today. Throws pass behind the intended receiver, and incomplete. He was looking for Thomas Glover in the flat.
Well, Delaware now really running to the football well, recognizing that was going to be a wide receiver rocket screen to the wide side of the field, a play that early on in the game they didn't adjust to quite quickly enough, but now in the second half, that versatility, all that coaching coming to bear. I just love the way the defense is running around the field, playing a lot of different personnel combinations as well, Scott.
And good for Scott Day, Sports Information, that does an excellent job. New Sports Information Director taking over for Scott Stellheimer. He gave Drew Nichols a half a sack on that play with Troy Reeder, and I think it was well-deserved by Nichols, the freshman. Punt coming from Null. It's short. Running up to it is Papali. It'll bounce to the 40. It'll take a Cornell hop down to the 30-yard line. It bounced backwards about 11 yards down at the 29. 9:43 remaining in this one. And Delaware on top, 21-3. We'll take a timeout on the Blue Hen Sports Radio Network.
Rush hour or relax hour. It's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart. Moving forward.
As the American Spirit postgame show will be with us at 9 minutes and 43 seconds left of the fourth quarter. Still a lot of football left, but you feel like Delaware is certainly on their way to 2-1.
Well, they've been much sharper offensively in the second half. The defense continues to dominate the line of scrimmage, and the back end has really risen to the occasion, breaking on balls much better than they did in the first half.
Drive will start at the Hens 29-yard line with Kehoe under center, first and 10. Play action pass coming up from Kehoe. Down for his favorite target today, Joe Walker catches it. Another big gain into Cornell territory.
Excellent protection sets that up. Walker continues to win the one-on-one matchup, just using his speed, but also a little clever move at the start, a little buzz of his feet. gets him that extra separation. And Pat Kehoe in rhythm now on the long ball, is really starting to feel that touch coming on.
All the way down to the 30-yard line. Walker had a 42-yard catch earlier in the game. That one good for 41. And the Hens have first and 10 at the Cornell 30-yard line. Kehoe under center. Bunch trips to the left side with Scarf, Tyler, and Papali. They'll pitch it to Kane running that way to the outside. Stiff arm gets him upfield. A flag is thrown back at the 30 as Kane gets down to the 23. Kane shoved out of bounds, but the flag was thrown as he tried to turn the corner there.
Holding, number 85 offense, 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's Charles Scarf, and that's the seventh penalty against Delaware. Six penalties against Cornell in this one.
Well, that's something Coach Rocco will have to talk about in the film tomorrow and also going forward this week, kind of cleaning up some of these little issues. Sometimes you just get caught. The defender moves on you a different way, and that hand, I'm sure Charles's left hand, gets caught on the outside part of the frame, resulting in the hold.
Moves the football back to the Cornell 38-yard line. It's first and 18 after the penalty. Give is to Kane to the outside, and he gets down to the 34-yard line. A gain of four as Kane ran strong to the outside left, but not too much there.
McClurge, the cornerback, comes up to make the initial tackle on Kane, and he just bounced off of him like he was a little bug. Kane is so physical. It's pad level. It's leg drive, but it's also that mentality where he's always fighting and working hard for that extra yardage, really trying to inflict damage on the tacklers as they come in to make the play on him.
Kane's 16th carry a moment ago. He had 17 a week ago against Lafayette. Second down and 13, approaching 8 minutes here in the fourth. 21-3 lead for Delaware. Snap goes to Kehoe. Kehoe stepping up, throwing, looking for Scarf. Scarf tries to reach over the defender, but because the defender had his head turned around, no penalty, it was Malik Leary, the linebacker, who did get his head turned around as he got in the way of Charles Scarf.
Well, they'll probably say that he was entitled to that space as Scarf was running across the field. Nice design there, a little bootleg action, bringing Scarf right to left. That's a crossing pattern that he and Kehoe have really developed a great relationship on this year.
Incomplete pass makes it third down and 13, 7:53. Fourth quarter, ends up 21-3. Fifth play of the drive, a 41-yard gain from Pat Kehoe to Joe Walker. Walker, 154 yards receiving on the day. Screen pass caught by Coleman. He's got some running room at the 25. He'll be stopped there. Gets to the 23, but setting up fourth down and short. I'm sure we'll see Frank Rago come onto the field.
It's a nice, but not too conservative a call. It's a wide receiver screen. It's a tunnel screen. You try to get the wide receiver up into a tunnel formed by his two blockers to trips, and also the pulling right tackle Noah Bay getting out there. It almost broke, just an extra, the safety worked downhill at a perfect angle to stop probably a first down.
Coleman's first catch of the season, he had eight a season ago. It's going to be a 40-yard try for Frank Rango. Pritchard will hold. Koronek will snap it. Rango with a 40-yard try. He missed earlier. This one good from Frank Rango. His third field goal made of the season. And Delaware goes up 24-3. 7:02 remaining here in the fourth. And the Hens looking good, doing what they need to do to certainly secure this game. At 7:02 left at Cornell, 150 yards of offense. Delaware's 362. You feel like just this one certainly out of reach for Cornell. It has been for some time as they scored a field goal on their opening drive and really have not been able to move the football since.
Well, they came out and, as Coach Rocco said, really scripted that initial drive. I think they took some pages out of Rhode Island's playbook, as we mentioned. That was as sharp as they've been. Delaware immediately made adjustments. They've reacted much better to the wide receiver screens. They've done a good job of bottling up the multi-dimensional running attack. And I think for the most part, they've done a good job of pressuring Banks, especially here in the second half. Banks has had to do a lot of things with his feet, stepping up in the pocket, and now not allowed to throw the ball down the field because he doesn't have enough time. And that's saying something, because when you watch the front five of Cornell, very veteran. Four seniors and one junior all played last year. A really solid group. So for Delaware to be able to put that much pressure on a veteran Ivy League line, that's going to really pay off dividends down the road.
Roth has it teed up, ready to kick this one away. Jones is back to return. Just as good as everybody stayed on the sideline, usually when Roth is kicking. Although this one is going to be returnable. Jones going to take it from out of the end zone. He's running sideways at the 15, now 20-yard line. Ray Jones, the first man to hit him. I love that again. We've talked special teams when you're up 24-3. There's under 7 minutes left, and your senior linebacker is making plays on special teams. That's impressive stuff.
It's the character of the team. It's the way Coach Rocco has built this. It's the special teams attitude. Clint Stenham and Manny Rojas doing a great job of coordinating that. Really a dominant factor in all three games has been the special teams effect. The punt returns, the kickoffs, the placements, everything has really come in. Outside of that one bad snap, I think Delaware has really performed at an incredibly high level in special teams.
Richie Kenny in at quarterback for Cornell. We saw him in the first half. He'll throw to the tight end, Fitzgerald, and he is smacked by Buchanan and Kedrick Whitehead. That's a true freshman sandwich on the tackle, and really impressive stuff. We're seeing Buchanan, Nichols, and Whitehead, of course, the present very strong linebacker, but that's the future of this linebacker corps.
Boy, it certainly is, and the future is bright.
It is.
Johnny Buchanan, we talked about earlier, but Kendrick Whitehead, I got a chance to do some of his games in high school, Scott, and boy, is he a versatile. He was an offensive and defensive player, very active, a very fine tackler.
Picked up 7 yards on that first throw by Kenny. Kenny going to go out of the pocket and throw it out of bounds as he was being chased. Cavado, Charles Bell for some senior leadership still in the game at this time. And Kedrick Whitehead, you know, he could have had his senior year at Middletown to fool around and do whatever he wanted to do. Instead, he graduates early from Middletown and comes and works out with Delaware in the spring. I think that made a big difference for the young man who's already making an impact as a true freshman. I'm very impressed with him. It's third down and three. Ball the Delaware 31, excuse me, the Cornell 31-yard line, 6:14 to go. Ends up 21 points, 24-3. And Kenny will take the shotgun snap. Pats his feet a few times, throws a dart high for his intended receiver, Clower. And it's fourth down and three with 6:06 on the fourth quarter clock.
Another pass well defended by Tenny Adewusi. Kevin Trezzolini right on point with that article this morning about Tenny. He has improved, as we've talked about. He's long. And he's very physical, and he gets his hands in there without creating a pass interference. So he's really improving his skills. Charles Bell did a nice job of working underneath that route as well.
Teddy, the senior. And now fourth down and three. The offense staying on the field for Cornell. Pumping is Kenny, rolling to his right, pointing at a receiver. He's going to try to run for it, throws it high at the last moment, and incomplete. Trying to get it to Owen Peters. A late flag is thrown, though.
It may be a hit out of bounds, Scott.
It was certainly in the direction and the timing of perhaps Sal Morrow going to possibly give Cordell some life. Our friend Eric Lewis again, soaking up the attention before making the call.
After the play was over, personal foul, number 98 on the defense. Delaware will keep the ball after the 15-yard penalty, first down.
So Sal Morrow, the guilty party there.
Well, Sal hustling hard. He flushed the quarterback out of the pocket, did a good job of running. He's just got to understand, once he gets that close to the boundary, the quarterback's going to be protected at some point. Just run by him.
And we'll take a timeout here on the Blue Hen Sports Radio Network with Delaware up 24-3.
Are you facing a financial crisis because of nursing home bills?
Lofton is in, Spruill is in, Williams is in, all running backs. Robinson behind Joe Walker, who is at the quarterback position for the second time today. Don't know if we'll call it Wildcat or not, since he is a quarterback that is used to playing out of shotgun form. But Walker will turn, give to Robinson, the transfer from Penn State, to the outside left. He picks up about nine on his first carry of the day.
That's an interesting formation. The quarterback Walker right behind in pistol. Then you have two adjoining halfbacks to each side and then a tailback. A really nice block there thrown by the senior redshirt Kareem Williams, freeing up the run to the left. A nice call there by Matt Simon, showing a lot of versatility in his play calling today as well as formationally adjusting.
They gave Robinson eight, so second down and two. Walker's going to stay in, same formation. And again, turning, giving to Robinson. And again, Robinson with some good yardage to the 30-yard line. An eight-yard pickup, back-to-back runs for eight. The same exact play, the same exact result for the transfer.
We talked so much about Vinny Papale and his pass-catching abilities and his punt return abilities, but boy, is he a consistent blocker out on the perimeter. Does a great job of inserting his hands inside the frame, keeping his feet moving, having great balance. A really nice block at the point of attack from the wide receiver as the run developed to the left side again by Robinson.
Kehoe checking in back under center for the redshirt junior quarterback, who's thrown for 254 yards thus far. First and 10 from the Cornell 30-yard line, and Kehoe has Kane behind him. Kane will get the carry straight away, burst through the first line of defense and gets caught up by the secondary. A 10-yard gain for Kenai Kane, and that's all he needed to move the chain.
Left guard Chuka from Concord High School threw an excellent block there on a quick pull, almost like a little gut action where the guard pulls up on the linebacker. Delaware's offense really in rhythm now.
And a timeout's going to be taken. It's like David Archer and Cornell want to talk things over. They'll stop the clock with 4:34 remaining. And we'll stay right here as the Hens up 24-3. Don't forget, during the American Spirit Federal Credit Union postgame show, which comes up after the game, we'll talk with head coach Danny Rocco. Also talk to our State Farm player of the game, Benny Pinella. He's back in the studio. He'll have scores from around college football. He'll have all of the highlights, all of the recap. If you miss anything in this game for the Blue Hens as they head to 2-1 on the season, and then we'll get you an update on the schedule as the Hens, they have some packing to do for the first time this season. After three home games, the Hens will head to Fargo, North Dakota next Saturday for a highly anticipated game against the reigning national champs. It's all coming up after 4:34 expires on this fourth quarter clock. Delaware has it first and 10 at the red zone, 20-yard line for Pat Kehoe. Play action, Kehoe. Towards the end zone, Joe Walker almost had another one. He threw it behind Walker, who was twisting, trying to find the football. Reached his arm out, but could not haul it down.
I think Pat Kehoe saw that the cornerback was underneath of that route and was hoping that Joe would sight adjust on the throw. He threw it outside almost as in a back shoulder action. Not miscommunication, but just a little bit of a problem there as Kehoe tried to make a play that Walker wasn't ready for.
Second down and 10, 4:28, and Walker, so impressive. His best day as a wide receiver, six catches, 154 yards. He had a 42-yard catch and a 41-yard catch. The converted quarterback from Philadelphia. Second down and 10 from the 20 in the red zone. Kenai Kane straight away, powering for 5 yards. Down to the 15, maybe the 16-yard line. It'll be third down for the Hens. Timeout taken by David Archer once again. One timeout remaining for Cornell as third and six about to come up. And Cornell, this is a hard team to gauge at this level playing against a CAA team in the Delaware Blue Hens, but they like what they have going into Ivy League play. This is a team that's looking to improve, and David Archer, since he's come in, he's only won 12 games in his five seasons, but they think this could be a year because of some momentum late last season, some games that they played well against the top of the Ivy League, that this could be a team that fares all right in conference competition.
Well, they had a win against Princeton and a win against Harvard, who they had not beaten since 2000, and that Harvard program has dominated the Ivy League up until the last couple of years. Yale winning the Ivy League and being undefeated last season. So David Archer and the staff are really optimistic. They've grown this program. I think they've recruited really well. This is the second full transition of seniors that Archer's had. He's an ex-Cornell player. We mentioned that as an offensive lineman. 6 years as the offensive line coach before taking over at 35 as the youngest coach in the country.
Yeah. Here's Delaware on third down and six in the red zone at the 16-yard line. Double tight end set. Running back is Lee next to Kehoe. Kehoe takes a shotgun snap. Lobs, end zone, Jarman knocked away at the last moment. Great defensive effort. And it was DJ Wooler, the safety, who made the stop. And correction, that was to Joe Walker. But either way, it was an even better play by DJ Wooler, the 6'1 senior from California.
Walker just couldn't get any separation. Woolard, as you already mentioned, the senior from Fullerton, California. Great coverage into the boundary. Not a badly thrown ball by Pat Kehoe. Sometimes the defense just makes a better play.
33-yard attempt coming up for Frank Rago. Pritchard will hold. Fourth down and six from the 16. Kick is up. And Frank Rago ends back-to-back drives with field goals. We'll take a timeout with a heads up 27-3 over the Big Red. 4:06 left to play.
Your local Chevy dealers and the Delaware Blue Hens are both looking forward to a winning season. And with
and 52 seconds, ending with a Frank Rago field goal of 33 yards. He made one from 40 earlier, and the operation on those field goals is pretty smooth.
We talk so much about Frank Rago and his consistency, 72 PATs in a row, great leg, a clutch kicker. But that doesn't happen if you don't get great protection from your line and your edge players. But Skylar Korniak has done a really nice job as the short snapper, and of course the punter, Nick Pritchard, is the holder, and that's an operation that's got to be flawless. You have about 1.35 to get off those field goals and extra points, and they are really exquisite at their technique.
We see Mike Katniss in the game as the quarterback. He's going to throw the tight end with a catch. Grab made by Tommy McIntyre. There have been a lot of players in the mix. That's the, I believe, the 11th receiver to catch a pass for Cornell in today's game.
Well, they've spread the ball around. They treated this, I have a feeling coming in, not like a scrimmage, but they knew this was going to be a tough game, so they wanted to play a lot of different people, stay as injury-free as they could for next week's encounter with Yale.
Conference game coming up for Cornell as Katniss throws the out route out of bounds. It was looking for another target, Davy Lozana. He's got a couple catches in this game, Lozana does.
Cornell last night had an opportunity to dine at the Hotel DuPont, and a good friend of mine, Rob Buccini, who's one of the primary founders of Buccini Paulin, who played at Cornell, also at Wilmington Friends School in the 80s, did a nice job of fronting that for Cornell. So a really nice job by the Cornell alumni helping out down here.
Well, they might not get away with it. I'm sure they ate well coming into Wilmington last night. Paquel with the carry to the right side. Brought down from behind. I think got enough for the first down. Then you get to the 35-yard line. That's where they'll mark it. And a couple guys, again, for Delaware getting into rotation is Brandon Nixon, the defensive lineman from Cape Henlopen, local guy, making the snap, stop his first tackle this season.
Saw Brandon Nixon play in high school from Lewis, Delaware, as you mentioned, Cape Henlope, and a very active big man, played both ways down there at Cape for Bill Colick, a very physical player at the point of attack. I think he's going to be a good one down the road.
Played last year against Cornell in what was his only appearance. Pumping is Katniss, the quarterback, throwing, has a man open. It's a tight end at the 40-yard line, pushed out of bounds at the 35, and that's the second catch of the drive for Tommy McIntyre. And now you got the second unit for this Delaware defense in the game. You got the first unit saying, hey, we haven't allowed a touchdown.
And I guarantee you that's going on the sideline. Yeah. Corey can probably attest to that. They'll be very vocal here. They do not want to give up a touchdown to this Cornell team, no matter what the score.
Shoveout was made by Brian Dennis from Concord High School. First down and 10 at the Delaware 35. The outside again. Another catch made. Lars Peterson this time at the 30-yard line. 2:40 remaining. Cornell has plenty of time if that is a goal of theirs, which I'm sure it will be, to get into the end zone. Down 27-3.
Cornell doing a nice job of protecting Cadenese, who's a nice thrower of the ball. They have three quarterbacks that can play. It's an interesting rotation playing three. We'll see how that pans out for them in the Ivy League.
Bunch
run.
Trips to the left side on second down and four. Ball at the Delaware 29-yard line. It's Pakel again up the middle and diving for first down yardage to the 25. So the drive will continue for the Big Red as the clock is winding down. It's set down to the sideline. And Corey Nido.
Scott, well, as Bill mentioned, the coaching being done here on the sideline by the older players and more experienced players of this defense. And Sir Adderley is yelling towards the team on the field to make adjustments. And Bill's right. They do not want to allow a touchdown to the Big Red. And you have about 13 coaches on top of the regular coaching staff right now for the Blue Hen, Scott.
Thank you, Corey. Certainly adding some excitement to the final 2 minutes of this game. We know Delaware's going to get the win, but by how much? Katniss will keep it to the outside. He is dropped by Andrew Pawlowski, the sophomore from Maryland. Had two tackles in 11 games a year ago in his first wrap-up of the season.
Pawlowski got a lot of reps in the spring, guys, when Brown was injured and could not participate. I really like this player. He's long and rangy. He's got good coverage skills, especially in the short passing game, and a very good tackler.
Second down and five at the 20-yard line of Delaware. In the red zone goes Cornell. 27-3, they trail. And Katniss will roll out to the right side, being pressured, tucking, running for the sideline, trying to pick up that first down, reaches for it. It'll depend on the spot of the football. Need to get to the 15, I believe. They'll mark him out at the 16-yard line, far side of the field. So third down and one with 1 minute and 11 seconds remaining.
Nice play made there by outside linebacker Matt Bowie, running very hard to force Katniss out of bounds. Did a good job there recovering after the, what we call the belly read fake that allow the quarterback to escape out on the perimeter.
Third down and one. Cornell, 6 of 16 on third down today. Second unit in for Delaware defensively. Shotgun snap to Katniss. Give is to Pakel. He gets the yard he needs, and it'll be first down from the Delaware 13-yard line after Pakel, the senior who missed most of last season, gets the yardage they need.
Pakel's got to be a bright spot for Cornell. He's run the ball very hard. He showed some good speed on a jet sweep earlier in the game. A versatile runner, the senior is from Santa Ana, California.
46 seconds left. Cornell trying to get into the end zone. Down 27-3. Mike Katniss with two wide receivers to both sides will give it to Pakel again, grinding his way up the middle to the 10-yard line. And the clock still ticking at 31. David Archer, he wants to get some points on the board. He'll call a timeout. He'll have the scoreboard showing that he'll have one timeout remaining, but I thought that it was his third and final timeout. I believe we just heard that over the PA system. So 23 seconds left, and certainly could have just ended this game and headed back to Cornell and gotten ready for Yale, but pride is on the line, and these guys want to get into the end zone. Delaware has not allowed a touchdown since week one against Rhode Island, so both teams have a lot on the line. Certainly not a win or a loss on the line, as Delaware is going to improve to 2-1, but both squads fighting, one to keep the ball out of the end zone and the other to get in for the first time.
I think David Archer is doing exactly what any coach would do. What a sell to his team. We were able, even though it was on their twos, able to score against one of the best defensive teams in the FCS. So this is a big confidence builder for his offense. And he, to his credit, has some subs in himself.
He does. Not the first team offense on the field. You're right, Bill. Worth noting, as Delaware has the second, maybe third team guys in the football game. And David Archer talking to the official. 31 seconds left. Delaware going to improve to 2-1 on the season. Back-to-back wins after Rhode Island, who we are learning might be a pretty darn good football team. Came in here week one and got a two-point victory over the Hens. And Katniss will go out of shotgun on second down and six. Ball on the 9-yard line. And Katniss pumps, throws, end zone, has a man, back corner, it's caught. And a touchdown for Cornell. The first touchdown given up by the Delaware defense since week number one, and with 26 seconds remaining in the contest, Cornell, their first touchdown score. It was caught by Davey Lozano, the junior wide receiver.
Lozano ran a quick fade pattern. That was three-step. Cadenas did a really nice job of placing the ball as you would do. It's almost a barrel drill where you train your quarterbacks to drop the ball in a barrel right at the edge of the end zone in the end line. A really well-thrown pass there. Not badly defended by Delaware, just a better offensive play.
In coverage for Delaware, I believe, was Brian Dennis, the 5'9 cornerback from Wilmington, Delaware. Extra point up and through, so it's going to be 27-10. Doesn't look as pretty, but a win is a win no matter what, and certainly that first team defense came out and played a hard-fought, really solid football game for the second week in a row.
Yes, they did, and I love the adjustment by the defense. It would have been easy to let Cornell score a touchdown on the first one, a game you expected to win. Maybe no matter how much it's preached, looking ahead a little bit to North Dakota State, a nice scripted drive by Cornell at the open, but Delaware then really tightened up everything, made total adjustments, flipped the time of possession in the second half almost to even. A really good job by the offensive staff also working the ball downfield, allowing Kehoe to feel really comfortable in the passing game. He's got the short game, he's got the heavy run game with Kane and Lee and himself, and very impressed with the play calling to allow Pat Kehoe a lot of runs as well.
And in front of an audience that used to play defense pretty darn well for this Delaware Blue Hens team, as Paul Warlow, we spotted him in the crowd earlier today, the Philadelphia Eagle, who unfortunately will miss the season with an injury. Andrew Pierce we saw walking around as well. So now the muddle huddle for Cornell as they have every player bunched at the 30-yard line. Delaware ready for perhaps an onside kick. Now Cornell will spread out and Delaware will do the same.
Good design by Cornell. It forces the kickoff cover team to be in bunched very closely. They might have been able to actually pooch the ball over the top and have a chance with a running start.
Cornell will kick this one away. No one back deep for Delaware as it'll bounce into the end zone and be a touchdown with 26 seconds remaining. A 27-10 victory if it stands this way for the Delaware Blue Hens. And, you know, Cornell bookended this game with a field goal and a touchdown. Everything in between was all blue and gold.
Yes, it certainly was. Almost 400 yards offense for Delaware. Cornell gets a lot of their yardage on the first and the last series, but in between, Delaware's defense really rallied to it. I thought they were exceptional at making adjustments as well as running to the ball this afternoon in their team pursuit. Outstanding overall team speed. Tenny Adewusi, I thought, had a really nice game at cornerback as well.
And Delaware are going to get in victory formation. Pat Kehoe is going to do the honors. With 26 seconds remaining, Pat Kehoe will take a knee, and Delaware will take the victory, improving to 2-1 on the season. A 27-10 win for the Delaware Blue Hens over the Cornell Big Red. Coach Archer, Coach Rocco talking to one another at midfield. And I'm sure Rocco telling Coach Archer, you've got a hard-working football team that you should be proud of as you head into Ivy League play. And for the University of Delaware Blue Hens, you know, you take the disappointment of week one, and what you need after that is a bounce-back, emphatic victory. I got that against Lafayette. And this week, you were looking to stay healthy. You were looking to remain solid in many aspects of the game. And you can check all those boxes. The defense played well. And on offense, again, Pat Kehoe, we saw him manage the game and do a little bit better than that. He found Joe Walker on point down the field a couple of times, a 42-yard pass completed, a 41-yard pass completed to Joe Walker. I like the fact that he was trying to go down the field to Jamie Jarman, didn't connect, but the throws were there. And then Kenai Kane, he proved once again very hard to bring down. He scored a touchdown on 65 yards rushing. But you look at both sides of this football team, and I think he got what you wanted over these last 2 weeks heading into the North Dakota State game.
A very solid performance here. I know at times the offense was a little sporadic, but I think that's the way, unfortunately, it was going to go if you're going to take those shots down the field. Now, that's something that North Dakota State will have to game plan for. That opens up the field for the under routes and hopefully the run game. I thought the offensive line was very solid. The defense, tenacious, exceptionally at running to the ball, tackled very well. Bell and Brown and Reeder were terrific, and Ray Jones made some really nice plays out on the perimeter after that first drive. Special teams continue to function at a very high level, and I just think if they